What is up, guys? Welcome to something a little bit different today, something very special to me. We are going to be going through my run through March Madness, TTM's March Madness. If you guys didn't catch wind of my draft review or the video that I posted up at some point, it was like a 2-minute long video announcing the stream and everything. Token Minorities, who are very big and very well recognized in the Draft League community, a channel run by Jolt and Styx. Both TTM, the Token Minorities Jolt, and the Token Minorities Styx. Well, Jolt organizes biannual tournaments every year, and one of them happens in March, and the other one, I believe, happens in July. And they're pretty big tournaments, and this one was actually the biggest one that they've done. And if you don't know what March Madness is, it's a basketball tournament. So they decided to bring that idea into Pokemon, and it was essentially, we'd have a one-day tournament where everybody has a drafted team and they play against each other. And it's bracket format, and whoever ends up on top at the end wins. It's really simple, really cool, and really stressful. And I was not ready for this event, guys. I'll tell you right now, I got about 3 hours of sleep, 3 to 4 hours of sleep before having to wake up and getting on call and finishing up my building for my teams. I was on call with Johnny Risepool, our good friend. He's been a good friend for a long while now. I would say about 10 months to a year almost. So we've known each other for a while, and we were going to help each other build throughout this tournament because actually we were both all-stars. And the way this works is basically anybody can sign up for this tournament. They were capping it out, I believe, at 200 people. And there were 40 all-stars. What all-stars are, basically, there were a few honorary all-stars, but basically every league, every big league from the Draft League community in Pokemon, of course, chooses three of their best players to send to March Madness as all-stars. So we were selected by the GPC, the Montreal Habsols. I am wearing my Montreal Habsols shirt, if you guys can't see. I don't know, am I visible with this on cam? Let's... right here. So if you didn't catch that on Twitter, it's a really cool shirt. You guys should go check it out on Redbubble. You can find it pretty easily. But yeah, so we were selected by the GPC. Myself, Zazzo, who I've mentioned so many times in the past few weeks, and Johnny. And we were all playing for the GPC. And my team, if you didn't get a chance to take a look at it, is I started off, I think, by drafting Tapu Bulu, Infernape, Zapdos, Nidoqueen, Skarmory, Milotic, Haxorus, and Mega Alakazam. Those were my all of my mons, my 8 mons, because we had 8. I'm just staring at my screen right now because I have a replay that I'm going to show you guys. I'm going to show you my run through the tournament and how it went. So, started at 1 p.m. Eastern, 12 p.m. Central Standard Time, and at this point, I was ready. I had all my teams ready. We had what was called a pre-bracket round. I don't know. It was the pools. Basically, everybody was playing in their pools. We were divided up into either 4 players if you were just somebody signing up, or into 5 players in one pool if you were an all-star. And I had a few players that I knew in my pool, so I had to prep for those 4 matches, essentially. So all my teams were done. I was about to get ready. Get started. Let's go. It hits 1 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. I hop onto my team builder to make sure everything is okay. 2 of my teams are deleted. And I'm freaking out. I'm like, oh god, I can't remember everything. I built these teams the morning of, and I couldn't remember any of my sets. I was stressing out. I was like, what am I going to do? But I still had 2 teams left. And the first person that challenged me, I had a team ready for him. So I was like, okay, let's go. Let's do this. We'll deal with the building after. I can speed build. All I have to do is do well in the 2 matches where I do have my team set, and then I can perform decently well in the last 2, and I'll be fine. So I had no idea that only 2 people out of the 5 in the all-star pools advanced. I thought it was 3. So I was like, oh god. When I found out that it was only 2 people, I was like, oh no. Am I going to make it? So I'm going to show you my first replay, guys. This was against Ashton and Akai. Ashton is actually in... I'm going to leave a link in the description to all of my opponents if you want to go check them out. Ashton is with us in the NPL Minors. He's not doing too hot, but he's still a very good player. I've seen him play, and he comes up with very creative sets and is tough to read. So I knew that I had to play against him. Replay should be popping up on your screen. He challenged us first. I was like, okay, let me just make sure all my EVs are in place, and let's go. So you see the team that we brought. What I'm going to do is I'm actually going to switch sides and reset. So, common trend this tournament. I had to face quite a few of the same Pokemon over and over again because obviously people know what they're doing and you end up facing Mons repeatedly because good players will draft similar Mons because they're typically good. So as you can see, my opponent has Mega Beedrill. I'm actually going to pull up real quick. Hold on. All right, sorry guys. I was pulling up the team, the full team. So Ashton and AS Rowlets. I don't remember what AS stands for the life of me, but he's the Rowlets, and he was representing the PPL Division 2, the Pokemon Premier League, and he has a Tapu Fini, Necrozma, Infernape, which is his Z-mon. Ours is also Z. He's got a Zygarde 10%, as you can see on your screen, a Tsarina, which he did not bring. He didn't bring the Fini or the Tsarina, which the Fini I was kind of surprised about, but the Tsarina I understood. Mandibuzz, Mega Beedrill, and Magnezone. So I see the matchup, and I'm like, okay, I think I'm okay here. And what I'm also going to do, guys, is I'm going to bring up the team that I brought real quick on screen. I'm kind of doing this off the cuff, so it's not proper, it's not professional, but I have all the teams saved here. So for Ashton, I brought Choice Banded Bulu with Woodhammer, Stone Edge, Horn Leech, and Toxic. Now, I knew that his only potential switch in to my Bulu was his Mandibuzz. If I could get that Toxic or land a Stone Edge on it, I was good to go. I had Infernape with Poisinium Z, was for the Tapu Fini. I packed Swords Dance, U-Turn, Gung Shot, and Close Combat. That destroys his team, as you can see. U-Turn was for momentum on the Necrozma. Zapdos, Leftovers, Thunderbolt, Hidden Power, Ice, Roost, and Agility. This set could completely wipe his team off the map. I could sit in on his Magnezone if it wasn't Specs and just Roost up on it, and then get up Agilities and wear it down with Thunderbolt if it wasn't Leftovers either. And then everything else was dropping if rocks were up. Like, Infernape was going to die. I had 136 special attack EVs with a boosting nature, so I was modest. I had 108 speed, which put me at 263, which is just faster than what? Than his speed creep on something, potentially, I think. Otherwise, it was his... No, I think it's his, it must have been a speed creep somewhere. Anyway, I had 263 speed. I had a Mega Alakazam with Psychic, Dazzling Gleam, Calm Mind, and Encore. So as you can see, Calm Mind just destroys him. And anything outside of a Scarfer, I outspeed because I was running a Timid Nature. So I could outspeed his Mega Beedrill. 252 special attack and 40 HP. I'm running a Milotic with 252 HP. Should have been 248, but anyway. 196 defense with a Bold Nature and then 60 in SpDef because I wanted to be able to take hits from the Magnezone specifically because I could recover off, Protect in front of it, Scald, and Mirror Coat. Now, actually, this set, this Milotic set, I just want to give a huge, huge shout out to Envy, Lord Envy himself. We were in call together and we were planning out our teams. This was the night before March Madness happened, and he was like, you should run Protect and Mirror Coat on your Milotic. I was like, why? He's like, well, you can scout to see if you're in front of a Scarfer, like let's say a Scarf Magnezone, you can scout what it's locking itself into and then make an appropriate switch if it's an electric move, or if it's Flash Cannon or even Volt Switch and you want to get an easy kill, you can just hit Mirror Coat. And I was like, okay, that's actually quite smart. I'm going to do that. And I packed enough special defense on there to be able to take Magnezone's hits a little bit better. And then my last Mon is a Nidoqueen with 248 HP, 132 special defense, and 128 speed, putting me at 242, which is faster than a max speed Magnezone. That's what I wanted to outspeed. My set was Earth Power, Ice Beam, Sucker Punch, and Stealth Rocks. Now, during this game, this is more a story than it is games, and it's that's why I'm on webcam, guys, is so you can watch me talk as I'm describing this. This was more of a story for this entire event, and while this game was going on, CJ, Choice CJ, who was my co-host for the Game of the Week series on the GBA channel, we're both analysts. I've moved over to Power Rankings now, but I love CJ. CJ's a really cool guy, and he was in my game, and he was watching. Because he was waiting for another game to start. And at the same time, I think Burke was also watching my game. and they were both watching this, and I was talking to them in the GBA analyst chat as I was making plays, and you guys are going to see, I was also talking to Daneki at the same time, and the reason I'm mentioning this now is because Sucker Punch on Nidoqueen was specifically for Beedrill, and you guys are going to see how this plays out, so let's get into the game. I'm going to lead off with my Nidoqueen against his Necrozma. I'm going to go for Stealth Rocks. He's going to go for Psychic. I know that I can take that because of my special defense investment. I'm going to keep my Nidoqueen around, though. I'm going to switch out into my Milotic as he goes for another Psychic. Doesn't get a Spidef drop. Awesome. I'm going to, I believe, just throw out a Scald here. Yes, I do. As he goes into Mandibuzz. So this is fine. Probably should have brought Competitive Milotic instead of my Marvel Scale because, as you guys are going to see right here, he's going to be able to Roost, defog away my rocks, and my Nidoqueen is low now, so that's kind of bad. I am just going to keep throwing out Scalds. I'm praying for a burn, and I do get it on this turn as he goes for a defog. Unfortunately, I'm not, like I said, I'm not competitive, so I don't get the +2 special attack. I'm going to switch out now, and I'm going to go out into my Zapdos, as he's going to knock off, and he's going to get rid of my leftovers, which is kind of bad because I needed those to be able to set up in front of the Magnezone. But he's going to switch out into his Magnezone now as I just throw out a Thunderbolt. I do 30% to this thing. That's awesome. He's going to Volt Switch. Now, remember, guys, I said I had 263 speed on this Zapdos. That confirms to me that his Magnezone is Choice Scarfed and not Specs. It's no other item. It is Choice Scarfed. So that is amazing for me, as you're going to see later. He brings in a Zygarde. I'm like, I'm just going to Roost on his attack from his Magnezone just to see what it is. And now he's going to pull out a nice switch into his Magnezone, predicting my Milotic to come in. But because I have the Protect, I can scout what he's going to go for. He's going to go for Volt Switch, and now I can make a switch back into my Nidoqueen, predicting another Volt Switch, as that is what he goes for. Very easy right here. I'm just going to get back up my rocks, I believe, on this turn, as he's actually going to switch out into Zygarde. I was fearing the Mandibuzz coming in, but regardless, my Nidoqueen was gaining back health at this point, which was awesome. He's now going to go for 1,000 Arrows, and I do see that that is not choice damage. Now, I predicted the Zygarde to have Sludge Wave on it, from the get-go. I knew that it would be packing Sludge Wave. I've done that so many times for Tapu Bulu, Whimsicott. I did that last week in the gym at GPC for Whimsicott. I ran Mental Herb with Sludge Wave. So that was a very, very likely bring on his part. So I see that that's not choice banded damage. So I'm just going to throw out a Scald right here. And this Mandibuzz takes 24%, and now because I burned it, it's actually in range of another Scald, which means he's never going to be able to get rocks off the field, ever at this point. So I'm just going to knock out his Mandibuzz right there. Now he's going to go into his Mega Beedrill. Now, Mega Beedrill can hit me for too much damage, but at the same time, I don't really want to be poisoned. While it's not bad because I do have the Marvel scale instead of the competitive, I also don't want this thing taking more residual damage than it needs to, so I believe here I am going to go for the Protect to get back a little more health. He is going to go for the Poison Jab. And I think on this turn, I end up switching. I stay in and I think I recover right here. No, I Scald, excuse me. And I see how much damage that Poison Jab does, and it does way too much. So I'm going to Protect. He's going to go for a knockoff on this turn, and I'm like, okay, that's fine. That's cool with me. And now I'm going to switch out into my Nidoqueen. And he goes for a U-turn. So call it a prediction, folks. That knockoff had no chance of taking me out. But look at his Beedrill and look at the health that it's at. I am going to now switch out on this Necrozma with my Nidoqueen because I cannot stay in here and take a Psychic. Actually, I'm going to Earth Power as Ashton decides to set up Stealth Rock. So that's awesome. I was actually sacking off my Nidoqueen. And now I'm going to switch out. And I'm going to go out into my Milotic as he's going to go for Moonlight. So this is going to allow me to recover up and get back to full. And I have no real way to touch this Necrozma, but he goes for Charge Beam. And this right here, guys, this is probably one of the most important turns of my entire tournament. Not because of this game. That's what's really cool about these tournaments, is it because it's not because of this game that this turn is important. It's because in the grand scheme of things, I now know that Necrozma is going to probably be carrying Charge Beam for me in the future. So you're going to see that come into play very soon. So he's going to go for another Charge Beam, and here I go for Miracope, and I'm able to take off 61% from this Necrozma. Now, my Milotic doesn't have haste, so I'm going to throw out a Scald. I'm going to get a burn. He's going to go for a Moonlight. I do see that I am faster than his Necrozma as well, because I did EV myself to be a little bit faster than Speed Creep over my Milotic. And now I'm going to go for another Miracote. He's sitting at 17%. My Scald now kills him. It's definitely still a roll, potentially. He's going to go for Moonlight, though. I want to recover up, because now, as soon as he attacks me, he's going to drop, because he's at +2 now. So he's going to do a ton of damage to me, but he's just going to take a ton back. And my Scald is going to, he's going to be guaranteed in range of Scald after the next charge beam, as you guys are going to see. And I'm going to be up to as much health as I possibly can be. So my idea there was, even though he's leftovers, I can recover up. If he charge beams again, then I'm back up to, I'm back down to about the same amount of health, and then I can just Scald. But if he moonlights, I can play it out this way. So that worked out perfectly. I'm able to Scald him. He was lower than he was before. He was lower than 17. Now my Milotic is at 72%. His Magnezone comes back in. I have no reason not to protect, and he explodes. CJ died. CJ died when he saw this play. He was laughing so hard. And I even told Ashton in the chat, I was like, dude, why would I not protect? Like, you've seen protect. You were faster than my Zapdos. I clearly know that you're scarfed. There is zero reason for me not to click protect right there. And Ashton even agreed. He didn't play the best game. I understand, though, and I will talk about that a little bit later, but I'm able to just kill the Magnezone for free, essentially. Now, he's going to go out into his Beedrill, and I know that my Nidoqueen actually cannot take a Poison Jab from the range it's at, I believe, but I'm going to switch into Nidoqueen, and he goes for the Poison Jab, and no, I do take it, excuse me, yeah, I take it, because I can take anything but a knockoff from that range, including U-Turn. I saw how much U-Turn did before. Poison Jab is actually quad-resistant, and that's why I love that hit. So, I'm going to now... As you can see, his B is at 13%. It can no longer come in on rocks. Bam! The Sucker Punch comes into play, knocks out the Beedrill. That is perfect for me. Now, his Zygarde, I don't want it Dragon Dancing up, so I'm just going to go for a sack on my Nidoqueen. It did its job. I'm now going to go out into my Milotic, and he's going to go for an Outrage, and he actually two-hit KOs me from here, and I make the mistake of Scalding, fearing that he might set up, because a plus one Outrage won't kill me, but two Outrages will. Now, I'm going to switch out here into my Tapu Bulu. Unfortunately, after the next Outrage, this sometimes still confuses you, even though it's not very effective. It still counts as the two turn, and it would confuse you, but he got the three turn Outrage. So, this kind of sucks for me, but the thing is, I know that his Zygarde is probably not choiced. I'm going to stay in here, and I'm fearing, like, okay, I might actually still lose to this thing, because it is a big pain. And it can have E-Speed, and 1,000 Arrows into E-Speed is going to hurt Zapdos. It's still at full, I believe, where it's at right now. So I could technically set up an Agility, go for HP Ice, knock out the Zygarde, and knock out the Infernape. So it's not the biggest deal, but I know I'm going to get smacked with a Sludge Wave right here, guys. I know he's not choiced. But it turns out, Bulu, thanks to that HP investment, that slight amount, the 32 HP that I had on this thing, I was able to take the Sludge Wave and live. So that was really cool. His Infernape's now going to come in. It's going to go for a Flare Blitz. And basically at this point, I know that unless he's Choice Scarfed, he's not going to outspeed my Mega Alakazam. I'm going to find out right now if he is Choiced by tracing Iron Fist and going for the Psychic. And I knock out the Infernape, so I get a 4-0 win. I figured that his Infernape wouldn't be Scarfed. Bringing dual Scarfers against me didn't make much sense. And plus, I have a Milotic. You never really want to lock yourself into Flare Blitz against a team with a Milotic on it. So I really wasn't thinking that it was Choice Scarfed. So that game went really well. Now, again, I still have two teams to build. We're rushing for time. Our games have to be done in 2 hours. Or less, I believe. No, it was 2 hours. An hour and 45 minutes. We have to finish our games. So I'm like, this game already took a while. The next one is promising to take a while as well, because it's against a very good player who's actually been in the GBA, has a GBA title, and is also currently in the NPL. So I was kind of scared. I didn't think I would be able to pull out this game. I really thought I was going to lose, in fact. But our next opponent, and I'll slide it over here, is going to be Crobat for the win. Hashtag free Danza. If you guys don't know, Danza, Crobat for the win. He's actually the one running the stream through the entire event. Like I said, he's the Los Angeles Nidokings. He has season one, I believe, championship of the GBA. And he's also currently in the NPL with the rest of the guys, with Jolt, with Gypsy, Zazo, Merc, everybody. Riz. So, I forgot to mention Togue. Wow, sorry, Togue. Everybody in there. You guys know what I mean, but if you're watching this, but... let's go over Danza's team really quickly. So this is gonna be easy. He has a Celesteela. I really thought that was gonna come against me, guys. I have a Tapu Bulu, and Tapu Bulu just ran train through his team. So I really didn't understand when I saw this team, as you guys see in front of him. He has an Necrozma, a Sylveon, Thunity, Darmanitan, Superior, Donphan. So those six came, and then he has a Mega Gyarados, and I had to be ready for the Mega Gyarados as well. So I was kind of scared about his team. I was looking at it, it dealt with me really well, and the biggest problem to me is Thunderous T. So as you guys can see, I'm up against another Necrozma. So at this point, I'm thinking, okay, well, this Necrozma is probably going to be Charge Beam too, right? Because I don't have great switch-ins to a Charge Beam Necrozma. My only immunity to electric is my Nidoqueen, and my Nidoqueen gets bopped by Necrozma, so it makes 100% total sense for that thing to be running Charge Beam Psychic, because that destroys me. So I'm looking at his team, I'm like, okay, how do I deal with Thundee? How do I deal with Serp? How do I deal with everything? And the team that I decided to bring, as you can see, is Zam, Infernape, Skarmory, Milotic, Nidoqueen, and Zapdos. And I'll go over the sets. So my Mega Alakazam is Psyshock, Shadow Ball, Charge Beam, Encore, and I'm Modest, with only enough speed to outspeed Scarfed Sylveon. Nothing else. Because as you can see on his team, he doesn't have great speed tiers. Like, his fastest mon right now is his Serp. And if anything comes Scarfed, it's going to come Scarfed to outspeed my Mega Alakazam anyway. So I ran 100 speed, bare minimum, just enough for a Scarfed Sylveon, because I could see that as a potential threat. And 100 speed EV is, like, realistically, what am I wasting? I have 152 in HP, 4 in defense, and then 252 modest, like max special attack Mega Alakazam. This thing hits 493. This is one of the main reasons that I picked it up, was because it just tears through things. My Infernape set is Poisonium Z, Flare Blitz, Gunk Shot, Mach Punch, U-Turn. I readjusted the team a little bit with Johnny, with Johnny Risepool before I ended up playing the game. And we made a couple of modifications to it. I also talked with Jar and MV and CJ the night before about the team. And I had a little bit of a different set. I had Thunder Punch on this Nape initially, and I decided to switch it out for Mach Punch because ultimately his Mega Gera has to Mega Evolve turn one. So I could always U-turn or Mach Punch it. And that was the main reason that I had Thunder Punch on Infernape, was for the Mega Gyarados. So I was able to replace the Thunder Punch with Mach Punch, which ends up becoming very important in this game. Flare Blitz, Gunk Shot, Poisonium Z is obviously there for the Sylveon, as you guys can see. And then U-Turn was just for momentum, so that I could always switch out against things. Skarmory is leftovers, Brave Bird, Whirlwind, Roost, and Taunt. Honestly, I'm looking back at these sets, and it's just like, wow, dude. I have Taunt on here with enough speed to outspeed a min speed Necrozma, so that I can at least taunt it. And then Whirlwind is there in case he wants to set up with anything, like a Calm Mind Sylveon, his Serp if it gets out of control and it's behind a sub, his anything realistically. If his Darmanitan wanted to be cheeky and go for sub Belly Drum, I could Whirlwind it out. So that was the idea there. Milotic, Rocky Helmet, Marvel Scale. I brought Rocky Helmet specifically for Darmanitan, so I couldn't just perpetually U-turn on my team, or just fire off Flare Blitzes. It would need to wear itself down in the process. If Rocks were up, then I had him. He was dead. And Scald, Recover, Haze. Haze was there for the Necrozma once again, running enough speed again for a slightly speed creeping Necrozma, like 12 speed on it. I also have 12 speed on my Milotic so that I can outspeed that, or even just a little more speed actually. And Scald also deals with the likes of Darmanitan with his Donphan. Next set is Nidoqueen. Now, this was a very common Nidoqueen set that I brought throughout the tournament. It was Piapa Berry. I'm running Poison Jab, Ice Punch, Stealth Rocks, and Toxic Spikes. I decided to rock a max attack, max special defense Nidoqueen with a gentle nature, which was minus defense plus special defense. Ultimately, I didn't end up running a special move, so I shouldn't have been minus defense. I should have actually been minus special attack. That was a mistake in prep on my part, because I reworked some sets, and I had 8 speed on there just in case of a speed creep again. So that this was actually a big mistake on my part, but Jab is there for the Sylveon, of course. Ice Punch is there for the Serp, for the Thunderous. Biggest things. And then Stealth Rocks and Toxic Spikes. Like, Toxic Spikes can do a lot of damage to his team. Look at the team he brought. Everything gets hit by toxic spikes except for Thunderous. So that could do a tremendous amount of work to him. And then finally, my Zapdos was Roost 3 attacks, which is the most common Zapdos set you see on the ladder right now. Heat Wave, Thunderbolt, Hidden Power, Ice, Roost with 72 special attack, 32 special defense, Calm, so that I could potentially take on his Thunderous. 156 speed, which put me at 275, which is enough for something speed creeping Bulu, and I can't remember what it was that I thought he would speed creep Bulu with. Oh yes, that's right, Gyarados. His Mega Gyarados, I figured, would want to speed creep my Tapu Bulu, so that at plus one, it could still knock me out with like an Ice Fang, for example, if I was weakened. The three attacks hit his entire team. Like, Thunderbolt chips away at Necrozma, it hits his Sylveon, if it's not defensive, pretty hard. It hits his Darmanitan. The Heat Wave was there for the Superior. The HP Ice hits it just as well. But he also has a Celesteela, so I could mix up my moves realistically. I could keep going for Heat Wave. He wouldn't be able to switch around on them. And then HP Ice was for Thunderous. And Hidden Power Ice was also for the Dawn Fan, so I could hit it as hard as possible. Heat Wave still does a good amount of damage, but HP Ice would like be guaranteed from certain ranges. So that's the team that I brought for Danza. Now, this was one of the most technically played games throughout the entire tournament for me. Like, every single move had to be perfectly calculated against this guy, because the NPL is scary, man. I'm telling you, like, if I actually move up from minors this season, I'm terrified of the players that I'm gonna have to go up against, because they're all really, really good. They're all of this caliber. So this is our game two. So like I said, guys, we're up against four people in the pool stage. We need like 3 wins, 1 loss to advance, guaranteed. So I'm gonna go through this. This might be a long video, by the way. If you've clicked on it, then thank you. So he's gonna lead off with Necrozma. I'm gonna move to normal, and I'm gonna lead it with Nape, and I'm gonna go for U-turn. And he gets weakness policy, and I'm like, oh no, this is horrible. What do I do? I'm like, all right, well, my Skarmory is specially defensive. I brought max special defense, by the way. 176 HP, 252 SpDef, and 76 speed. My Skarmory is specially defensive. If he clicks a psychic move, then I get to whirlwind him out easily. He can't knock me out with anything after. And if he gets, if he goes for anything else, then I'm easily whirlwinding him out. So I'm gonna go on into Skarmory. That is exactly what's gonna happen. He's actually gonna go for Rock Polish, so he reveals a move to me right before. So this set could have completely swept me. But thanks to Skarmory's excellent ability, Sturdy, I am definitely not gonna die to anything he goes for. No crit, no nothing. And I'm gonna be able to whirlwind this thing out of here and get it out. He does 78% to me with a charge beam. Like, that was actually terrifying. I'm gonna whirlwind him out into Sylveon. Now, initially, I didn't think this was a good thing, because this thing could be faster than me and be rocking, and also be rocking HP Fire if it's a spec set. So I was like, okay, well, I gotta get out of here. I have to keep my Skarmory. I can still heal it up later, and I can whirlwind out his Necrozma at any given moment. So that's perfect. That's exactly what I'm gonna do. So I'm gonna switch out into Nidoqueen as he actually doubles into Thunderous. I'm guessing fearing an Iron Head or capitalizing on my Roost makes the most sense. But I'm actually gonna be in with Nidoqueen against this Thunderous before it gets a chance to attack. So this is like perfect situation for me. He's gonna go for a nasty plot. And I already knew what was coming. So I go for Ice Punch. I'm gonna break his Yachi Berry. He dies to the next Ice Punch. And this is like the perfect turn for me. He goes for Psychic. I knew that he'd bring Psychic for Nidoqueen and not HP Ice. I brought the Pyapa Berry, and I'm gonna knock out the Thunderous. So now I still have my Nidoqueen. His biggest threat to me, in my opinion, is gone. It's dealt with, no more dealing with it. I'm like, Danza, stop with the offense. I even told him in the chat, you guys can't see it, but I'm like, damn, Danza, offense out the ass. Like, this guy brought weakness policy, Rock Polish, Necrozma, and a nasty plot Thunderous. Like, he was just going in the first 5 turns. So I was like, okay, dude, you gotta calm down. I'm gonna switch out here into my Milotic, and he's gonna go for a Rock Polish again. And I believe this is the turn that he reveals Charge Beam once again, guys. So I'm gonna go for a Light Screen on the following turn. He's gonna go for another Charge Beam. And this Milotic is, I didn't go over it, but it's Light Screen, Scald, Recover, and Haze. So this is perfect. I go for a recover. He gets another charge beam boost. But now I'm behind. He gets the first one here, actually. I'm going to go for Skull to slowly weaken this thing. And I see that Skull actually does a lot of damage. So he's not invested in HP at all. So it's going to be hard for him to take hits. So he's going to go for Moonlight right here. I think I Skulled again. I actually haze on this turn to get rid of his rock polishes, just in case anything wonky happens. He's going to go for another charge beam, get another boost, that's fine. I'm going to go for a Skull. I see that his Necrozma is actually speed creeping whatever speed I have on my Milotic, so it's actually pretty fast. I'm assuming that at plus 2 it could outspeed my max speed Alakazam. I'm going to go for a haze on this turn on his Necrozma, and then I'm going to heal up. As he goes for Psychic, and he misses out on the KO by 2%. This was such a crucial turn. I knew that Psychic would do more than Charge Beam, because Charge Beam's base power is 50, so super effective it goes to 100, and Psychic is base 90, so with Stab it goes to 135. So I knew that it would do more, but I didn't think it would do that much. I was actually terrified when that happened. He goes for another Charge Beam, gets another boost. I'm gonna go for another recover right here. I still have my left, I don't have my leftovers. What am I? He goes for Psychic, I go for another recover right here, and I think I'm gonna haze on this turn, if I'm not mistaken, I just go for another recover, and I'm actually terrified at this point, because I don't know what's gonna happen. Like, it's looking very shaky for me, but right here I'm gonna haze, and I'm gonna keep my Milotic. So my Milotic is really low, it'll die to a Psychic at this point, but I'm like, okay, I can't let this thing go down, because I need it for weakening Dawnfan. I just need as many Mons as I can, and I absolutely needed to chip away at the Darmanitan, because I still haven't seen what kind of set it is. So I'm going to get out of here. I know that I can recover up on the Dawnfan. I'm going to go out into Zapdos as he goes for a Psychic and does a tremendous amount of damage to me. I'm like, oh god. But I am offensive Zapdos, slightly. I am 72 special attack, so I'm going to do a lot to this thing with a Thunderbolt, because Zapdos' special attack is naturally higher than Milotic, and I also have investment in it, and Thunderbolt is stronger than Scald, so I'm gonna do like 40% of this thing easy. So I'm just gonna throw out a T-Bolt right here. He's gonna go into Sylveon, finally revealing what it is, and it is defensive, and he brought specially defensive, I believe, specifically for Zapdos. It does seem to be, it could just be physically defensive. Now that I'm thinking about it, it probably is. But right here I get a free switch out into my Nidoqueen, as he actually reveals the Heal Bell, so great bring on his part. My Toxic Spike is not going to do as much damage anymore to his team. He's going to bring in his Dawnfan. I'm still going to go for a Poison Jab regardless, just in case he decides that staying in is a good idea. I'm going to get off a lot of damage. So he's actually going to pull a nice double here back into his Necrozma on my Nidoqueen as I go and get up a Toxic Spike. Right here, I'm again terrified of this thing, so I'm going to go out into my Mega Alakazam, not allowing him to gain any momentum on me. Like, if he went for a Psychic there, whatever, you know? I'm an Alakazam, I can take a Psychic, even if it's from max special attack. He actually ends up going for Moonlight, and I have Encore. So I go for Encore here, thinking that he might want to stay in and try to set up on me, but realistically, I should have thought twice. Shadow Ball does a ton even through Prism Armor because he's not defensive. So I should have probably, I know his four moves, so I should have probably just attacked on this turn. But I decided I'm going to Mega Evolve because I have to. I Trace Pixelate, I go for a Shadow Ball, don't get a special defense drop, that's fine. I don't really want to take an attack from this thing, but at the same time, like, Psyshock is not a bad play. Either way, I'm going to switch out. I'm going to go out into Nidoqueen. He's going to go for a Wish. I know he can Wish up his Dawnfan, so I'm going to take this as a chance to force a Rapid Spin. I'm going to go for Stealth Rocks, and I'm going to get up a layer of Hazards against him. I now have two Toxic Mons, like two Poison Mons. He has to go for a Heal Bell at some point during this game. He has to waste turns healing up his team from things, like getting rid of Hazards, going for Heal Bells. He's going to go for a Rapid Spin right here. He takes Rocky Helmet damage, finally sees my item. That's what I am. Forgot. And I'm going to go for a Recover. I'm actually not going to go for a Recover on this turn. I'm going to switch out into Zapdos. I think predicting a switch out into Necrozma on this turn as he goes out into Superior. And I'm going to Heat Wave right here. You guys are going to see he's going to Taunt. And this Heat Wave is going to blow this Superior back and as I get a crit. So that was actually pretty important. Superior did have Taunt. I'm not exactly sure why. Probably for my my Skarmory so that I couldn't Whirlwind him out, possibly. But I did have Brave Bird, so I could still hit him for super effective damage. Either way, my team was very offensive, so maybe it was so Milotic couldn't heal up. I wouldn't stay with Milotic regardless. But now my Zapdos is back up to 79%, so this is good. I didn't even see that he said this. He said FML TBH. I'm sorry, Danza. I'm really sorry. But anyway, I'm going to switch out into my Skarmory as he's going to go for a Heal Bell. I knew he wasn't offensive, so I could take any hit. including a hyper voice because I'm specially defensive, get back a little bit of health, and I'm going to roost all of this off. So this is looking good for me, except he goes into Darmanitan, obviously capitalizing on me. So not looking good because I'm not in sturdy yet. So at this point, I have to start sacking things. I'm going to go into Milotic. He's going to go for a Flare Blitz. Milotic finally goes down. So did a ton of work, put in a lot of work for me, honestly. Kept the Necrozma checked for a little bit. And it also put pressure on his Donphan and stuff, just in general. And he did take a Rocky Helmet hit plus recoil, so that's really good for me. Now I'm going to go into Nape, because I'm under the impression that this thing is choiced. And either way, going for a Flare Blitz right here, or any move, realistically, is not a bad play. He's going to switch out, and he's going to go out into his Donphan, as I actually go for the Z Gunk Shot, predicting his Sylveon to come in. Now, this was a terrible play, because I had zero reason to go for a Flare Blitz, to not go for a Flare Blitz right here, because, I mean, it made no sense to not go for Flare Blitz. But anyway, he's going to get healed up a little bit. I'm going to switch out here, I believe, as he makes a nice, I'm going to U-turn, so he makes a nice switch out into his Darmanitan, predicting a switch out, as I'm now going to go into Skarmory. I want to get this thing back into sturdy, essentially, is what I'm trying to do right here. So I'm going to sack off my Nidoqueen, and he's going to go for a Flare Blitz, and now I can go right back out into my Infernape, because I'm pretty convinced this thing is Scarfed, and even if it's not, I can still attack for a lot of damage. So right here, he's going to go out into his Necrozma. I'm going to go for a Flare Blitz, and I get off 54% on this thing. I'm like, whoa, okay, yeah, this thing, like, this had no bulk whatsoever, guys. He's going to pull another switch out, this time into his Donphan. I'm going to get off a Flare Blitz. I'm going to crit him, and I'm going to leave him at 2%. I kind of wish I didn't crit him, because, as you guys are going to see, this man, it wasn't this game. He just ice shards me here. Yeah, right, sorry. So I'm not upset about critting him, actually. That's fine. I'm going to U-turn here, and this is actually a little bit of a weird play, because now I have to go into Zam, but he's just going to bring back in his Darmanitan. I should have just attacked, realistically. And now I have to switch out again. And I'm going to go into Zapdos, essentially sacking it, as he goes for a U-turn. So, awesome. I didn't have to sack off my Zapdos. That's cool with me. He's going to go out into his Sylveon. This is where the game gets really methodical, though. I'm going to go for a Thunderbolt, trying to get a para, seeing what he wants to do. Maybe he wants to attack me. He goes for a Wish. I can't let him Wish up his Darmanitan for free, so I do need to just attack on this turn, as he is going to go for a Toxic, and I didn't see that coming at all. I didn't see Toxic coming at all. I was like, okay, I could just sit in front of this Sylveon. I could just Roost and Thunderbolt it all day. It'll be fine. But he does reveal the Toxic, and I'm like, ooh, that's not a good thing. Now I'm going to pull a Heart Switch out into my Skarmory, thinking that he might not have an offensive move if he's Wish, Toxic, Heal Bell. He might bring Protect and not have any offensive moves. So now I'm back in sturdy, as he's going to go into Necrozma. I'm going to go for a Brave Bird. It's going to do a good amount of damage. However, he's going to go right back up to 71%. And right here is where I make like the really ballsy play of switching out into Alakazam. Not really ballsy, because technically, the only two moves he can hit me with are Charge Beam and Psychic. So, neither of those do too much to Mega Alakazam. As you guys are going to see, Charge Beam is only going to do 22%, so I'm not too concerned. Plus, he doesn't get the raise. So, now he's going to go out into a Sylveon as I go for a Shadow Ball. And I'm going to get a Spadef drop right here. But it's actually, I don't think this matters, because I go for Charge Beam on this turn, and I get a Special Attack raise. And he's going to go for a Wish. And what this means, guys, and I calced it, is that Psyshock kills from here. I knew I could take any attack, and I went for the special attack raise. That way, he had no more switch-ins to my Mega Alakazam. And I'm gonna go for the Psyshock here, and the Sylveon is officially dealt with, so I don't have to worry about that anymore. Now, the only problem left is this Darmanitan. Now, right here, I traced Prism Armor a couple of turns ago. If you guys missed that, I did trace Prism Armor. I have to get off of my wire. Okay. So I trace Prism Armor, so if he goes for U-turn, he actually doesn't knock me out. I calced it. But if he goes for Blitz, he destroys me. So I need to make my best play here, sacking off my Zapdos. It's toxic now, it's not going to put in as much work. So I'm just going to go into it. He's going to Flare Blitz, he's going to leave himself really low at 21%. And I'm going to go into Infernape, and I'm going to go for the Flare Blitz right here, I believe. As no, I go for the Mach Punch to pick off the Darmanitan. Another bad play because I knew he was choiced at this point. But just in case he wasn't, because I hadn't seen him switch up his move yet, but I wasn't sure. I just went for Mach Punch. And right here, I can go for U-Turn once again, going out into my Mega Alakazam, because it pretty much walls this indefinitely. And Shadow Ball will always kill from this range. He goes for the Rock Polish, and I'm like, all right, well, that's fine. I can just Shadow Ball. And you guys are gonna see, Shadow Ball does 55%, so there's no way he can stay in on me and just Moonlight forever. I'm just gonna fire off a Shadow Ball. He goes for a Psychic, he leaves me at 48, I'm like, okay, that's fine. I go for a Shadow Ball, and I'm thinking that there's no possible move that he can lock himself into to beat my entire team, plus I have Mach Punch on my Infernape. Thanks to, once again, my great front office suggestion from, I believe it was Jar, that told me to run Mach Punch. And had I not run Mach Punch, this Blitz would have killed. Maybe. It might have killed. I am an Infernape still. I'm still a fire type. But even if it killed, he died to recoil. So differential doesn't matter in this kind of tournament. So I'm going to go for a Mach Punch. And his Darmanitan is going to drop. And we do take a 2-0 victory over somebody that I was really fearing in Crobat for the win, Danza, and the Los Angeles Nidoking. So GG to you, Danza, if you're watching this. Thank you for the awesome game. This was really cool. But we're already 40 minutes deep. Wow. Yeah, this is going to be really long. Okay, so maybe this wasn't the best idea, but I'm just going to keep rolling with it. You know what? It's fine. My webcam looks like it's off, but I know it's not because I see myself like on the recording. But anyway, yeah, so at this point, I don't have the recording for the next game, guys. And thank God I don't, because this video would have easily gone up to like an hour and 30 minutes. If I actually had the replay, but I was up against Johnny GB and the Oregon Ducklets, and I'll just go over his team really quickly and what I brought for him. He had a Megalodios, a Terrakion, which was his Z-mon, Togekiss, Shaymin, Entei, Milotic, Metagross, and Crocodile. The mons that didn't come were, I believe, Crook and Shaymin, if I'm not mistaken. Yes, that's right. It was Crook and Shaymin. The other six came. He had a Megalodios, a Terrakion, a Togekiss, an Entei, his own Milotic, and a Metagross. So, through this tournament, guys, I discovered a new love for Milotic, because the way this game played out was, basically, I had nothing for Megalodios. I got really unlucky and then really lucky at the same time. His turn one of the game, I switch out of something on his Milotic. He goes for Ice Beam and he freezes my Skarmory. And I'm like, no, please, no. This is the worst situation ever. And then his Megalodios started setting up a Calm Mind. And I was in with my Skarmory. And that thing had Thunderbolt, Ice Beam, which, by the way, Bolt Beam coverage destroys my team. And Psy Shock, I believe it was, with Calm Mind. And my Skarmory thawed on the turn that he attacked me with Thunderbolt. And got off a Toxic. And if it wasn't for that turn, I would have lost to that Megalodios. I had a Scarfnape, I believe, that game. And what ended up happening was, it was really funny. Everybody in the chat was like freaking out. I really wish I had the replay so that I could just at least show you guys this moment. But my Milotic was in against his Togekiss. And I brought the right ability, I think. No, I brought the wrong ability. I think I brought the wrong ability. My team was... Hold on, I'll pull it up. I'll pull it up for you guys. My team was the Skarmory I talked about. Milotic with Scald, Recover, Ice Beam, and Dragon Tail. Dragon Tail, keep that in mind. Horn Leech, Mega Horn, Stone Edge, and Swords Dance. Kebia Berry, Tapu Bulu, which went down really early, I believe. Zapdos with Subtoxic, Signal Beam, and Roost. This actually put in a lot of work, too. It had no electric coverage, which was like the stupidest thing ever, because that could have just destroyed his team. But I brought Signal Beam so that his Megalodios couldn't set up subs on me. And it also hit his Crocodile, which should have been his dedicated switch-in. The only thing that I couldn't touch with this set was his Metagross, because everything else I could Toxic as well. So that was perfect. Infernape was close combat. I'll actually show you guys the team. I'll try to put it on screen here. Now I don't know which replay I'm on, but anyway, you guys see it right here. I'm in a pretty good setting so that you can see this. Is there any way for me to drag this down? No, not really. Well, this is my Skarmory set. This is my Milotic. my Talpabulu, my Zapdos, Infernape, Choice Scarf, like I said, and this is my Nidoqueen set. As you can see, I had the wrong ability on here as well. This was one of the teams that I had to rebuild completely from scratch, so I messed up a bunch of things. One of the things that I messed up was Skarmory. It was supposed to have Stealth Rocks instead of Spikes, because I mixed it up. When you have only 8 Pokemon, and you're bringing almost all the same ones to all your games, it gets really confusing really fast, and if you lose a team and you're trying to rebuild it, you confuse it with other mons. So... or like other sets, and I thought that my Nidoqueen had Stealth Rocks for some reason, because for another matchup I had Stealth Rocks on it, but it was 4 attacks, and my Skarmory, like this couldn't hit anything because it didn't have Sheer Force, it was Choice Scarfed, but it couldn't do enough damage. Skarmory was supposed to have Stealth Rocks, and that almost screwed me in this game. Not that it mattered too much, because it got frozen anyway, and then the only time it actually attacked was getting off a Toxic on Megalodios to save me the game, but Milotic was in against... This is the big part of this match, and I'll talk about it for a little bit. Johnny, I think, was just fed up at this point. I had my Milotic in against his Togekiss, and I had my Rocks up. No, I had a Spike up, excuse me. I had one Spike up because of Skarmory. And... Sorry. I didn't have any Spikes up. Excuse me. Whoa. I am forgetting these matches. Okay. Really wish I had the replay right about now, but I didn't have a Spike up. But my Milotic was proving to be a big issue for his team, because his Milotic was a Flame Orb set, so it was gradually wearing itself down, and it had to use up its recovers against me. And I was really low on resources, because his Megalodios put in a lot of work against my team. I think I was down to Infernape, Zapdos, Milotic, and I think like a really weakened Bulu. I didn't even have Bulu left. Nidoqueen died, and Skarmory died. So I only had those three mons left, but... My Milotic was proving to be a huge issue to his team, because I was Dragon Tailing things around, getting off damage. His Milotic was losing health because of its Flame Orb, its Burn. And mine was just sitting here leftovers and just healing up. And I was Dragon Tailing him around. And at some point, he was trying to PB stall me with his Togekiss. And his Togekiss was running Tri-Attack, and it was trying to hax my stuff. And because it's 40%, right? So, with Serene Grace, so I pressure stalled it out of Tri-Attacks with Zapdos so that it couldn't touch my Milotic anymore. And then at one point, he clicked Defog on my Milotic, and I forgot that I had messed up and put on competitive, and he gave me a +2. And I was like, whoa, wait a minute. Hold on, I'm at +2 now. I can do more damage to his Milotic. The only things he had left were a weakened Metagross, a toxic Terrakion. I had managed to get off a poison on it with Zapdos at some point during the game. I also expertly wasted his Continental Crush at some point in the game, which I was like really happy with myself about. He had his Togekiss left. He had his Milotic, his Metagross, and Terrakion, and Entei. All of them were alive. The only thing that had died was his Megalodios. And this Milotic, guys, took on the entire team. It just beat everything. It was so incredible. I was like, this has to be one of my new favorite mons. It has to be up there. Like, Empoleon did shit all for me in the GPC, but this thing, as a water type, came through so hard. Like, Scald, eventually, I think, like I said, Johnny was like fed up. He came in on my Milotic with his Togekiss again and clicked Defog again and gave me another +2 in special attack. And as a result, I was able to just destroy his team. I was able to PP stall his Milotic out of recovers and beat it with Scald. At the end of the game, my Milotic, literally, the only moves that it had left were 2 Scalds before... When I won the game, because actually what happened was I got his Terrakion down to 1%. It was still poisoned. I switched out into my Nape on his Stone Edge as I was at full with my Milotic, and he killed off my Infernape. I came back in with Milotic, and I knocked out an Entei, and at this point, my only 2 moves left. I ran out of Dragon Tails. I ran out of Ice Beams. I ran out of Recovers. All I had left was 2 Scalds. That's it. But this Milotic put in so much work. I was so happy with it, and I won the game. So this put me at a 3-0 record. So, I was like, okay, well, this is awesome, because I don't even have to have my last game and rebuild for it, even though I had already rebuilt for it, and I'll show you guys the team, that I built for my other game. Actually, no, I won't. I will not do that because then you're going to see the rest of my teams. And this is problematic, actually. Should have thought this through. Give me a second. All right, we're back. So you were back on the Danza replay. So at this point, like I was saying, I'm 3-0. I don't even have to have my last game. I automatically advance because of everybody else's records in my pool. So this is really cool. I didn't even think I would make it past the pool stage, guys. To be perfectly honest with you, I thought, like, because I lost those two teams and that I would have to reprep. And my record, in tournaments and just in leagues in general, is normally going 2 wins, 1 loss, 2 wins, 1 loss. But because I grinded it out so hard against Johnny and PP stalled everything and just won the game in like 125 turns, it was ridiculous. Like I was saying, my Milotic lost all its PP. Because I got that third win, I was advancing to the next round. So this was really cool. At this point, I could get a break because I had a chance to sit back because everything else that was going to happen in the following rounds was bracket play. And it was the first two waves, I believe, were strictly open pool divisions. So the people that joined without being all stars from their respective leagues. So I could just like take a break, go and eat. I was like so happy to just stop for a second because it was really stressful with the fact that I had lost my teams and I had to rebuild them and everything. But at this point, Johnny actually jumped in call with me because Johnny and Zazzo both got eliminated. They didn't get enough wins in their pools to make it onto the next round. So, unfortunately, they got eliminated. So, Johnny was like, Johnny got hacked so hard. Like, I felt so bad for him. He went 1-3, but he did not deserve to go 1-3, man. He just got hacked every single game. It was ridiculous. Like, even the one he won, it should have been a 6-0, and he lost because of a crit. He didn't lose because of a crit, but it came down to a 3-0 instead of a 6-0, which is, like, insane. So he got hacked literally every game. So he jumped in call with me. He said he was going to help me build for the rest of my matchups because I only had 15 minutes. This is the problem with this format, guys. It's not really a problem because I understand they still have to run a stream and they have to have everything run really smoothly. But the bracket play from this point on, the single elimination process, was we had, as soon as our matches were announced, we had 15 minutes to build. 15 minutes. And then we had to have our match. Like, I understand it's called March Madness, but do you understand what putting 6 mons together while looking at somebody else's team and thinking of the best possible sets is and what that does to somebody's brain, especially if they've never done it? I was like, and I'll get more into it when we get further, but like, I didn't understand how much... I thought it would be fine. I was like, okay, I've speed built before for other things. Like, I did the GBA showcase videos, which I still haven't finished, which I gotta get around to. But I would speed build in those because I didn't want to, like, keep the person on the call for too long. When it was Jar, it was late. We wanted to get it over with. We had to re-record one of those. So I knew what speed building was. I was like, okay, whatever. But I had never, like, really speed built. Like, being on a timer of strictly 15 minutes and having to build good sets for each opponent is, like, it's so stressful. And you guys are going to see that with my next match, and you're going to understand. So, this match was against Fries, and he's in the NPL Miners with us as well. So, this first wave, this first round of bracket play, was against, I don't want to say not great players, because they all are great players, but I put myself a little bit above average in general. I've said that before. I think I'm a good player. And these were still people from the open division. No all-star was playing against another all-star at this point. So I knew that I didn't have a huge behemoth of an opponent in front of me. So I was really happy about that. I was really content. So I ended up going against Fries. You guys now see his team on the screen. I am actually going to bring up his team right here. I had to make a quick cut there because I had to find it. He is the Rotterdam Straptors. And it's funny, I always see his team logo because it's like default on our thumbnail Photoshop document for the NPL Miners. But yeah, he's got Zardex, Tabu Bulu, so something in common with me. Here's another thing in common with me, Skarmory. Here's another thing that I've already faced this tournament. Thundee T, then Keldeo, Necrozma again. Third time that I have to face Necrozma in this tournament. He's also got Komala and Snorlax. And as you can see, he didn't bring the Komala or the Snorlax. He brought everything else. And I'll go over the team that I brought for Fries. As you guys can see, we've got Nidoqueen, which is a Earth Power, Ice Beam, Flamethrower, which was for the Skarmory. Stealth Rock set. I knew that I would always be switching out on his Necrozma. At this point, I had learned my lesson that Nidoqueen was never going to be staying in on Necrozma, ever. So I needed something to deal with that. My nape was Ferium Z. This was a suggestion by Jar. At this point, I was in call with Johnny and Jar. And Jar hopped in and he was like, just bring Ferium. Because Blitz, like, you can 2-hit KO the Necrozma if it's not defensive. I was like, oh, okay, well, yeah, that's a pretty good idea. And I'm Swords Dance as well, guys, on this setup. Mach Punch, Close Combat, Flare Blitz, Swords Dance, Ferium Z. As you can see, that does a ton of damage to his team. All I need to do is weaken the Keldeo, and weaken the Thundurus, and this set sweeps. I actually have 346 speed on here in case this Keldeo is like a more like passive set, like defensive. Excuse me, I just dropped something. In case it's a little bit more passive, then if I get up to plus 2, I can close combat as well. I'll know that he's probably not max speed, and that I'll always beat it in terms of speed, so that's good. Then I have the Skarmory, which is Brave Bird, Spikes, Toxic, and Roost. So Toxic was there because I wanted to hit the Necrozma with Toxic, actually. I needed a way to get that thing worn down. Whirlwinding it wasn't enough. I found that out against Danza. So yeah. Next up, I have Mega Alakazam with Psy Shock, Shadow Ball, which I knew I needed, Encore, and Calm Mind this game. So I could Encore the Skarm into Roost. I could Encore the Necrozma into Moonlight, anything like that. The Thundurus into Nasty Plot, if ever I had the balls to switch in my Mega Alakazam on a Thundurus. Anything of that nature, or even like Tapu Bulu on sub. If I was just sacking my Mega Alakazam and he happened to go for substitute with his Tapu Bulu, anything like that. So that's why I had Encore on there. And Calm Mind, you look at his team with a Calm Mind up, like Alakazam just runs through it completely. Like it destroys every single member. And then we have Milotic. Milotic, in this game I brought Skull, Toxic, Recover, and Dragon Tail. Like, a lot of these sets are similar, but this was a max defense variant. This was so that I could at least have a Zard X check and be able to just Dragon Tail it out and get it out of there. Toxic, again, was for the Necrozma so that I could... or the Tapu Bulu on the switch so I could wear it down. And I always had a good switch into his Tapu Bulu because of Skarmory. I ran a little bit of defense on Skarmory so that Stone Edge couldn't 2-hit KO, even if he was banded. I ran 36. That's all I needed. And then finally, we finally brought Haxorus. This is the first game that I brought Haxorus. And spoilers, I think it's the last as well. No, that's not true. This is not the last one. So, Dragon Dance, X-Scissor, Poison Jab, and Dragon Claw. X-Scissor was for the Necrozma because I have Mold Breaker. I break right through Prism Armor, and I hit him super effectively. I have Poison Jab on there for the Tapu Bulu, and then Dragon Claw hits everything else. All I need to do this game is weaken Skarmory, and this Haxorus wins. I'm a Haban Berry, and realistically, I wish I brought Yachi because against like Keldeo, if it wanted to go for Icy Wind, or against like Thundee, if it had HP Ice, I could always just, you know... I had the Haban Berry. I wish I was Yachi specifically for those setup targets, but I'm running an Adamant Nature, 176 speed. This puts me at 274, which again beats a speed creep on a Scarfer trying to outspeed a Scarf Tapu Bulu. So that was the idea there. So let's get right into this game once again. He's going to lead off with his Thundurus, and I'm going to lead off with my Nidoqueen. And once again, it's Nidoqueen versus Thundurus, and I am Pyapa Berry. So I'm going to go for the Ice Beam, but he brings in his Necrozma. And that Ice Beam actually does quite a bit, this time because I'm Sheer Force. So I'm going to stay in on his Necrozma because I know I can take one hit, and I need to get up rocks this game. So I don't even care. His Thundurus is not that huge of an issue because I have the Megazam. He's going to go for a Stored Power on my Skarmory, and he is going to now go for a Charge Beam. So the third person to bring Charge Beam against me. Like, everybody learned from each other and just brought Charge Beam against Skarmory. It's hilarious. I get off a Toxic on this Necrozma. He's now at +2 special attack. He's kind of a threat. So I am going to have to switch out here. and I'm going to go into my Nidoqueen on the following charge beam. So I do predict that turn correctly. He's now worn down with poison, and I'm going to switch back out into my Mega Alakazam, predicting a psychic type attack, but he actually goes for Moonlight. And remember, guys, I have Encore, so this is perfect. I'm going to Mega Evolve, and I am going to go for the Calm Mind, I believe, on this turn, because I expected him to switch, predicting the Encore, but he actually stays in and just goes for another Calm, another Charge Beam. So I'm like, okay, that's fine. I can actually go for another Calm Mind right here, because he won't break me with anything. And he goes for Stored Power. It does a little bit more. It does 27%, but still not enough. And now I'm just going to attack with Shadow Ball. I really wish I had Recover in that moment. That would have been perfect. But I didn't. And now I'm plus two Mega Alakazam. And he brings in his Thunning, and I'm like, okay, well, this is Scarfed. He goes for Dark Pulse. Actually, right here, guys, this was crazy. This was another insane moment. The server crashed. Do you guys remember our game against Fog? Where we were at the end of the game, and the server just crashed, and we had to completely replay our game. Right here on this turn, as he brought in Thundy, I knew it was Scarfed, but I wasn't going to switch out because he couldn't knock me out with anything, because I traced Prism Armor. So I couldn't be knocked out by U-turn, so I think I just went for a Psy Shock. Or the server crashed. I had just started eating too, and I was like, what the hell happened? Because I hadn't eaten on that break that I talked about earlier, but... So the server just crashed, and it came back online about a minute later, and Carney was actually able to save all the games. So we restarted right from where we left off. We didn't need to recreate, we didn't need anything. So huge, huge shout out to Carney for making that happen. That was awesome on your part, dude. Thank you for saving that game and just having us continue going, because the charge beam boosts, you know how hard it would have been to replicate that? That would have been so tough. But he's going to go for a Dark Pulse, and he's actually going to crit my Megazam. That would have not taken me out, like, in any universe, because I was +2/+2. I would have done, like, 40%. But he does, unfortunately, crit me through the boosts and knocks me out. I would have knocked out his Thundurus. But now I'm going to go into Infernape. Knowing that he's Choice Scarfed, because he just outsped my Zam, I can get up a Swords Dance if I want to. But instead, I believe I just attack this turn, in case he goes Keldeo. He goes into Skarmory as I go for a Close Combat. And that's going to do quite a bit, and I believe that Flare Blitz takes it out from here. But I'm actually going to go for an Inferno Overdrive in case he wants to switch into Keldeo. I have no reason to keep Inferno Overdrive because it doesn't do anything to the rest of his team. Like, his Thundy is Scarfed. I'm not going to go for a Fire move against his Zard. And his Tapu Bulu dies to Flare Blitz anyway, unless it's, like, super bulky. And I'm not going to... If he wants to switch into Keldeo now... Then I get off an Inferno Overdrive on that instead, which is awesome. So he's now going to go out into his Keldeo. I'm not going to stay in here. I have a perfect check to this in my Lotic. I should probably hide the brand here. He's going to go for a Swords Dance, though, on this turn. And I was like, oh, okay. Why did he bring Swords Dance? That's what I was asking myself. I was like, why did he bring Swords Dance against my team? And the reason is actually really funny, guys. And it all comes back to... I think I'm going to Dragon Tail here. Yeah, I get him out of here. He gets Dragon Tailed out into his Thundurus, and I'm like, whatever. I'm just going to stay in because I predict him not to go for an electric move, as I have a Nidoqueen in the back, and I'm going to Dragon Tail him out again and keep him really low. Put him, I think, almost in Mach Punch range, but let me just... Sorry, guys, had to cut it there for a second, but yeah, this was the turn that he went for the Hidden Power Ice, and this comes back to, like I was just saying, to having only 15 minutes to prep. Fries actually made a huge mistake. He saw the A on Ashton Akai when he went to our pools on the sheet to identify my team, and he thought that Ashton was me. And this was a big problem on his part. It was obviously he didn't have the right team against me. I questioned things like the Bulu coming and like Swords Dance Keldeo, and like a lot of things weren't making sense. Like, this matchup shouldn't have been this easy. So, I'm going to, I believe, Dragon Tail this Keldeo out again as he just goes for a close combat. Does 35% to me, not too bad. Dragon Tail is going to do... I actually go for Toxic here because I predict him to just attack and not set up as I Dragon Tailed before. And he's going to go for a switch out here into his Tapu Bulu. I believe I double Toxic'd here. No, I recovered. Okay. So he goes out into his Bulu. I'm scared. completely scared. And I'm going to switch out into my Skarmory, I believe. No, into my Nidoqueen because I don't need it anymore. He actually goes for sub, so he did bring sub Bulu, which was kind of funny, because I did have the Encore for that. He's going to go for the Horn Leech now. It's going to do a ton, but I am going to break his sub, and I'm not going to allow him to stay behind a sub. I'm just going to go for the Ice Beam, break this thing's sub, and he's going to go, I believe, just for a switch out, actually, into his Keldeo. But his Keldeo is super low, and I just went for another Ice Beam. And the thing is, being that he's a Swords Dance set, he's Aqua Jet. So I can actually stay in here and just fire off a Earth Power and leave this thing in range of dying to... I actually keep my Nidoqueen alive, of dying to the next round of Toxic after this. I'm going to switch out into my Milotic because I didn't think there was any way that he would go for close combat there because it wouldn't kill. So he does go for the Aqua Jet. I get that turn right, and he's going to lose his Keldeo as a result. But, like, this is so sad because he didn't even bring the right team against me, guys. This wasn't... like, granted, spoilers, I'm going to win, but... Like, it didn't feel right. It didn't feel right at all, me winning this game, because, again, he didn't bring the right sets, so he didn't bring what he should have. I'm going to Brave Bird, I believe, on this turn, as I am going to break the sub, and because he's an SD variant, I know that he's not Scarfed. He already showed sub and everything. He's Leftovers, and after the next round of Grassy Terrain and Leftovers, I thought maybe my Infernape might not be able to kill this, and I was kind of scared. I did have my Haxorus in the back with Dragon Dance Haban Berry for his Zard, so I'm going to go into Nape here, I'm going to Blitz, and I actually am going to knock out the Bulu, so that's awesome, and now he's going to go into his Thunderous, I believe, or his Zard first. Yeah, he goes into his Zard first. I'm going to close combat. He already said GG, well played, and then he confessed to me later that he brought the wrong team against me, so that was just really sad. I was really sad for him, that it had to be that way for him. I'm not going to pity him forever, though, because that's just not right either. I actually ended up switching out here into Milotic because I knew that he wouldn't go for... he would probably go for Dark Pulse flinches. So I was like, okay, well, let me go on to something a little bit bulkier and just fire off a Scald, I think, at this point. Yeah, and knock out the Thunderous. So I do advance past this round. Like I said, the pressure was going to start getting to people. Building in only 15 minutes, you're going to make mistakes. And... up until now, I hadn't made too many mistakes. My biggest mistakes were made because my teams were deleted and I had to rebuild them, but everything else was fine. Everything was good. I had my friends helping me build. Jar and Johnny were there for me the whole time. They were there for me. And so, like, up until this point, I was like, wow, that really sucks for him that he made that kind of mistake. But karma. Karma happens, guys. And anyway, so this was, I believe, top 32. And next up, I had to face one of three people, because the way they were doing this was they were announcing waves of games that had to be played. And like every time there was a 15-minute timer and they were running it on stream, and when the timer got to zero, you had to be ready to play your game. But they didn't have just everybody playing at the same time. They did it in waves so that they could watch different games at different times. And for some reason, I was always in the last wave. So I always had to wait the longest for my name to come up, and I could only take on one of three people in the next round, and they were some dude named Carnage, Togavar, as you guys know him, Chris Togavar from the Token Minority, well, technically from the NPL. I love this guy, he's so awesome. We play Rocket League together, we play golf with friends together, we talk all the time on calls. He's a really cool dude. And Donicky, if you guys don't know, was the reason that I'm a GBA analyst, essentially. He helped me out with clips for my application video for the GBA. He helped me out through all of that. He sent me mons so that we could record those clips. He traded with me. He recorded the clips. He sent them to me so that I could use them in my application video, show that I could edit. I've been helping him build his teams, a lot of his teams, because Dan is a really good player. But he's not the best team builder. He's getting there. He's getting a lot better with his team building. And those were one of the three people that I could play. And the fact that Dan was still around at this point, moving into top 16, because this was top 32, moving into top 16, Dan was still in the top 16, was already really impressive. And the fact that I was there, the fact that I didn't think I was going to make it out of pool play, and that I was moving on to the top 16 was already, like, mind-blowing for me. I hadn't lost a game yet. I was 4-0 at this point. I didn't play all four of my games in the pool stage because of what happened. The fact that we took too long on that third game and that the fourth one resulted in a draw. But all of the players from my pool were eliminated at this point. A bunch of players that I didn't expect to be eliminated were. I think Gypsy King, often considered one of the best players in Draft League format, was eliminated before I was. So I was like, wow, okay, well, this is already crazy. But moving on into the top 16, we did have to face Donicky. Supreme King JY over here is Donicky. And, is this the top 32? This is the top 16, right? Yeah, this is top 16. And I had to face a person that I've been dying to play against but I didn't want to play him in this setting, man, because it was just, it wasn't, I didn't feel like it was the right time. And so I have to play against Dan at this point. And he was like, good luck, man. He was like wishing me luck. He was like, because he's been making so many Yu-Gi-Oh references lately. And my name is actually derived from a Yu-Gi-Oh character, Aster Phoenix, who, and this is Jaden Yuki, by the way, Supreme King Jaden Yuki. So this is all Yu-Gi-Oh references. It was like Jaden versus Aster from the anime. So that was really funny. He was like, am I going to bring my Elemental Hero deck or my Neospatian deck? So basically, am I going to lose to you or am I going to win to you? Because Jaden did lose to Aster in the anime. But anyway, enough Yu-Gi-Oh stuff. I'm going to go over the team that I have. So as you guys can see, we have Zapdos. I'm Mono Volt Switch. Volt Switch, Roost, Toxic, and Defog. Those are my moves. So, like, I can't hit the Roserade, but everything else I can hit pretty hard. I can either Toxic or just Volt Switch out, which gives me a huge advantage. Again, a huge shout-outs to Johnny and Jar for helping me with these teams, man. I had 15 minutes to build this. Marvel Scale Milotic with Max Special Defense. I wanted this because I knew how much of a problem Megalodios was. I'm actually going to finish going over Dan's team really quickly. And Dan was in the, he was in the All-Star pools with us, and I have to find out where he was. Was he in the same one as me? Hold on. Sorry, guys. This is what happens when I record for, like, over an hour. Donicky was in H, yeah, so he was in the same one as me. So if I go to All-Star H, he's right here, Rosadenborg, there we go. Megalodios, Tapu Koko, Celesteela, which he didn't bring. Again, another person that didn't bring Celesteela against my team, and I have a Tapu Bulu, which is really interesting to me. Donphan, Volcanion, which didn't come, which I was like, what? Why didn't that come? I have nothing for that. Buzzwole, Zoroark, and Roserade that you can see on your screen. So like I was saying, my Milotic is Miracote, Recover, Haze, and Ice Beam. Ice Beam was there for the Megalodios. I knew that I could get a Toxic off on it at some point during this game, as it tried to set up on me, and that I could also Haze it, and Miracote it, and Ice Beam it. With my, like, Milotic was my ultimate Megalodios check this game. That's what it came for. Then Megazam has T-Wave. This I thought up on my own. I was like, okay. This set was wacky. Max Special Attack Modest, 20 HP, 236 speed, so it made me 395, which is faster than Tapu Koko. I have Thunder Wave, Psychic, Dazzling Gleam, and Psych Up. The reason I ran T-Wave was because the only things that want to come in on my Megazam don't want to take T-Waves, like Celesteela, for example. If I slow that thing down and it happens to be a setup set, awesome. If it can't move for a couple of turns, great. Sick. Like, I don't need to deal with it. Everything else died to either Psychic or Dazzling Gleam, and Psych Up was there for Calm Mind Megalodios so that I could beat it 1v1. I would Psych Up on it, T-Wave it, and then start Dazzling Gleaming it, and I would eventually win, and I would have a Levitate Mega Alakazam with +2/+2 or whatever. So that was the Mega Alakazam set. Infernape Choice Scarf. So this was actually quite a good set to bring. I brought Naughty Nature, 252 with a, like I said, a Naughty Nature, so plus attack, 108 special attack, 148 speed, so I hit 289. Now, this is actually pretty clutch. I hit 289, right, guys? All right. I have U-Turn, Flare Blitz, Grass Knot, and Close Combat. So I can hit a lot of his team really, really hard with this set. I love Scarf Nape. It's so good. You guys can also notice, I just wanted to go over this really quickly, none of my mons have nicknames. And I'm really glad I didn't nickname anything before this tournament, because I would have not had time to put nicknames on everything. And even if I did, I would have probably butchered them because I would have been rushing. So, thank God. Second time that I'm bringing Haxorus, and I believe this is the last time that I bring it. This set was mostly designed by Jar. He was like, okay, bring Focus Sash, which I was like, okay, yeah, that's actually a pretty good idea, because his form of hazards is like Roserade and Donphan. Donphan's gonna be too busy, like, not trying to die. And Roserade is probably gonna come a little more offensive without spikes. So this was actually a really good idea. Focus Sash, so as long as hazards weren't up, I was good to go. I could get up a Dragon Dance. I have Earthquake, Low Kick, Dragon Claw. Low Kick was for Celesteela. Dragon Claw was for everything except for Tapu Koko, which I could outspeed at plus one because I hit 289. And I also, I went, this is where my prep starts getting a little bit shaky. I went 289 speed on Haxorus and on Infernape because I was convinced in my head that Buzzwole hits 288. I don't know why. I was like, okay, Buzzwole hits 288 at max. So I can outspeed Scarf Variants if I'm at plus one. It hits 282. And I was like, why did I bring this much speed? I didn't need it. But anyway, I brought that much speed. So the only thing standing in this thing's way is a healthy Donphan that's not toxic and it's not coming in on hazards. A healthy Buzzwole, which is why I considered bringing a flying move on here. I really, really did. And this thing does get Aerial Ace. I was going to bring Aerial Ace over Low Kick. I was like, okay, I think I really want to bring Aerial Ace. And Jar's like, no, bring Low Kick because of Celesteela. I was like, man, I really want to bring Aerial Ace. But anyway, yeah, so that's the set. It's an adamant nature, 252 attack, 236 speed, 16 HP, and 4 defense. And Nidoqueen is Sludge Wave, Thunderbolt, Ice Beam. As you can see, that hits a vast majority of his team. The Thunderbolt was there for the Celesteela. And Stealth Rocks. So this is my main rocker. It's also my check to Tapu Koko. However, I ran max special attack, max speed. Or almost max speed. I ran 264 speed so that I could outspeed. Again, I'm not sure. What was I outspeeding on his team? What was his prep? Hold on. His Volcanion. There we go. Yeah. I was outspeeding a max speed Volcanion with the set. So that I could smack it with a Thunderbolt. So, let's get into the game. Dan went to Twitter immediately after this game. It's really cool. So I'm just going to play. As I lead off with Infernape against his 10 Grisner. This is another Yu-Gi-Oh! Reference, isn't it? How did he have time to nickname his stuff? Like, I'm thinking about this here, and I'm like, huh? How did you nickname your shit, dude? Where did you find time to do this? But yeah, anyway. This is a Yu-Gi-Oh! Reference. This is a Nordic god, I believe, from the from 5Ds. But I'm going to U-turn out here. I don't want to grass knot this thing right away. He's going to go for Stealth Rocks. I have Defog on this Zapdos, I believe. I do, yeah. So I decide to Toxic this thing first as he goes for Knock Off. And I actually go for another Toxic right here because I really think he's not going to stay in. And he's going to try to capitalize on my Defog. He actually does go into Shooting Star Dragon, the Latios. And I do get off a Toxic on it, so that's awesome. I'm going to get out of here with my Zapdos. I'm going to go out into my Latios, my dedicated check to this. He's going to Mega Evolve. Now that he's Toxic, I'm fine. I can chew hits from this thing easily. Watch this, guys. I think I go for a Miracote right here. He goes for Thunderbolt. I think I actually recover, maybe? Yeah, I recover to test the damage. And he can't stay in here and just keep firing off Thunderbolts because he's going to lose this game if he does that. Because he's letting this thing take too much damage. So I'm just going to go for another... I actually go for Haze on this turn. Knowing that I can live a Thunderbolt into another Thunderbolt if he's not boosted. So I'm going to now switch out into Nidoqueen on his Tapu Koko as he actually goes for Calm Mind. And I knew that he would have HP Ice. Like, he was guaranteed to have HP Ice. But I decided, you know what? I don't need rocks that much this game. I'm just going to go for a Sludge Wave and weaken this thing. Keep it really low. Put it in range of Scarfed Nape or my Mega Alakazam. I'm going to let him take out my Nidoqueen. I'm fine with that. It only came for Tapu Koko. So I'm going to go into Mega Alakazam now. Oh, I love being Magic Guard Mega Alakazam, man. I really do. Anyway, I'm going to Mega Evolve. I'm actually going to trace Sturdy on this Donphan, which is awesome. I'm going to go for Dazzling Gleam. Another one is going to kill it, but he's toxic. He's toxic, guys. I went for Dazzling Gleam because it kills, and it also hits
Zoroark on the Switch, which I thought he might switch out to, because if he scarfed Zoroark, then at least I hit it. But he is, of course, now at 20%. And there is an unreleased item in Gen 7 known as Custap Berry. And Dan brought it. He just brought an unreleased item that was banned from this tournament. And no heat to Dan, because he didn't know that that was actually a thing. But, like, eventually, basically, if I lost this game, we would have had to review it, because he did have Custap Berry, and my Mega Alakazam would have been at full. So, he now goes into Roserade, and he's going to hit me with a Hidden Power. And, wait a minute. Roserade's faster than my Mega Alakazam? I'm faster than Tapu Koko. So he's Scarfed. This is a problem. Scarfed Roserade is a problem to my team. Why did he bring this? No! I'm now going to go out into Nape. And I'm hoping... Well, first of all, I saw Hidden Power. So I don't think it's a Hidden Power to hit my Infernape. That doesn't make much sense. I'm thinking like Hidden Power Rock or Hidden Power Ice. For either Zapdos. I think more Hidden Power Ice to hit Zapdos, to hit Nidoqueen, to hit Haxorus. So I'm going to go into Nape. As he goes out into Ancient Gear Golem, and I hit it with a Flare Blitz, and I do a lot to it, and I know that I'm faster because Buzzwole doesn't even hit 289, but I'm 289 speed for some reason, and I go for Blitz, and I knock him out, and he's gonna go out into his Tapu Koko. I'm faster than this thing too, and I'm just gonna go for Blitz. He didn't expect me to be Scarfed because he just switched out of Roserade, and I am just naturally faster than Buzzwole. Now he's gonna go out into his Mega Latios, and I'm gonna pull out a Switch into my Milotic, as he decides to go for a Roost, and I'm fine with that because I can just spam Ice Beam now, guys. I can just click Ice Beam freely, no problem. Nothing can really reliably switch in. His Roserade takes like 70 from a crit. Unfortunately, I do crit him, but this is actually not going to end up mattering, as you guys are going to see. I'm going to switch out into Zapdos on this turn, and he is going to go for a Sludge Bomb. So he's going to not get the poison on me, but it doesn't matter because he's faster than me and he's choiced. So this is fine. Now I have a decision to make, though. I'm going to go into Nape. And the problem is, I don't know how fast this Roserade is. And I could very well be slower than it with my Choice Scarf because I brought 289 speed. I'm actually going to bring up a calculator. Oh, sorry, guys. I'm going to bring up a calculator really quickly. And we are going to do this right here. 438 divided by 1.5. 292. I was not faster than this Roserade, my friends. I was not faster than this Roserade. But I brought in my Nape anyway to scare it out. And he switched out into his Zoroark. And I go for U-turn. I didn't factor in that Roserade might be Scarfed, man. I just go for U-turn, and I'm going to go out into my Haxorus. Now, my Haxorus forces his Latios to come in, or so I think. So he's going to go back into Akiza, the Black Rose Dragon. And I'm thinking, well, this thing can't knock me out. What? Why is he in with this? But he goes for Hidden Power Ice. I forgot that he had Hidden Power. I'm sorry. It's definitely Hidden Power Ice. I'm now going to go back into my Nape, and now the problem is, he thinks that he's faster than me. Where he thinks that I'm faster than him. So he's just going to keep switching out. And he's going to go into his Shooting Star as I go for a U-turn, because it's going to kill Roserade. And I'm going to go out into my Milotic, and I can just sit here and stall him out. And I think I end up going for the Ice Beam on the first turn on his Roost to keep him low. And this actually does a really good amount of damage. It does like, 37, almost 40%. So he's toxic as well. He's taking over like a really good amount of damage. Here, I think I recover. As he is going to, I do recover, and I can recover stall this thing for days. So I am just going to keep clicking recover. It's kind of risky, actually, because had he switched out into his Roserade on the turn that I went for recover on the second time, I might have actually lost this game. But he's going to go out into his Roserade, and from here, because I'm max specially defensive, guys, I know that nothing that he clicks can knock me out. So he's going to go for a Leaf Storm, actually, and it does 75% because Milotic is a god, and I can't wait to draft this thing and nickname it. We do pull out a win. We win in top 32 against Dynakey. I just want to say, Dan, the Infernape was misprep on my part. It should have actually only come faster than a Scarf Buzzwole, But ultimately, scarf is scarf, and I think you were scared of it anyway, and that you couldn't keep in your Ozroid because you needed it to be my Milotic, because Latios couldn't do that on its own. But I would have actually lost had you ever attacked my Infernape with your Ozroid, because I wouldn't have had anything for it, and it could have just spammed attacks against my Milotic. Granted that Leaf Storm, while it would have done a lot to my Milotic, I could have just, you know, recovered up. But I think the big thing, ultimately, he had Custap Berry on his Donphan, which was illegal, so we would have had to review the game. But I think if he would have won, I would have just said, Dan, keep going. Keep going, it's fine. I don't think the game was on stream, so it wouldn't have ruined the integrity of the tournament. I would have just said, you know what, keep going. I'm fine taking the loss, but we do end up with a win because we scared out his Roserade enough times. So I do beat Dan. He didn't bring his Neospatian deck. He went to Twitter and he was like, great tournament, everybody. It was already really late for him because he lives in, I believe it's Norway. And it was already super late for him. And he was just like, all right, guys, thanks for the great tournament and organization and everything. And I did go out to Aster. He said this twice. He said this in his Discord server as well. He tagged me. He kept tagging me. He's just like, I went out to my good friend Aster. He did beat me. It was really fun, and I just want to say GG, Dan, if you're watching, if you're this far into the video, thank you so much for an awesome game. It was a pleasure playing against you, dude. I was really looking forward to the first time that we would be able to play against each other. But yeah, so this is my top 32 match. And now, like, all of these games, guys, going into the next round, it was coming up really quickly, because my wave was ending, and I had to stay sat in front of my computer because I didn't know which wave I was going to be on when they were announcing them. So this was the most stressful part, was like not knowing when you were going to get announced, who you were going to play against. We wouldn't find out until like right before the timer started. 15 minutes, boom, go. Now you have 15 minutes to prep. So it was like, oh my god. So going into the next round, I realized, wait a minute, I'm in top 16. I'm with some of the best players left in the field. This is incredible. Actually, no, this was top 16. Sorry. I'm going into top 8. I'm going into top 8, guys. I just made it into top 8 of the tournament. And I have to go up against, like, somebody amazing. That's guaranteed. There's only 8 of us left. It's got to be a good player. I'm not going to avoid them forever. They're still here, and they're ready for me. So me and Jar and Johnny got back in call after this game, and we're waiting to find out who I'm going to be playing next. They announced the first wave, and then there's only 3 players left other than myself. And I look at my odds, and I'm like, oh no. I'm either against some dude named Carnage, who I don't know where he's from. I apologize. I'm sorry. I've never heard of him before, but he's doing really well. And the other two people were Togue and Monotui. And Monotui, I've been praising for the past 5 weeks in power rankings in the GBA because he's been doing amazing. He's been shredding there. He's been shredding in NPL minors. Like, he's been killing it everywhere that he goes. So I did not want to play this man. I wanted somebody else to take him out of the tournament so I at least had a chance to win. But we got our matchup, and unfortunately, this one was another one that was not, that we didn't save the replay for. So it really sucks that I'm not going to be able to show you guys the game. But in fact, it was on stream. So I was able to download Dan's stream and we got paired up against Chris Togavor. I was actually kind of happy when this happened because I really wanted a rematch against Chris, guys. I'm not gonna lie. I choked when I last played him, which was like 9 months ago or something like that, when I replaced Rob in the NPL. If you guys go listen to that commentary for that game, actually, I never uploaded that game. You guys never saw that game. I meant to upload it. I had it saved somewhere, and then I just lost it. It was gone. I recorded everything, and then I never uploaded it. It was weird. But I think it was because it was the last game, and I think I thought I didn't need to upload, so I was like, oh, whatever, I won't release that one. But in fact, the NPL does require uploading, so Kind of weird, but anyway, that game that I played against Chris in the NPL minors, in the NPL, excuse me, last season when I replaced Rob, I had a really good shot to win, and I was already 2-0 in the games that I replaced Rob. Robin, I beat Aberforth, and I beat Sypha Blocker, and I was up against Togue in my last match that I was replacing Rob for, because he was coming back the following week. He just had a lot of stuff on his plate, as he always does, and my Greninja crit flinched his Sharpen Porygon 2 that was set to beat me. It was just going to tear through my team, guys. I was going to lose to a Sharpen Porygon 2. My Greninja crit flinch it and then knocked it out with a Hydro Pump on the following turn. And I could have won the game with Greninja, but I choked because I thought that his Blaziken was Scarfed. I messed up the game. Ultimately, his Pidgeot, his Mega Pidgeot ended up beating me because he EV'd it in a way where it could take a max special attack Ice Beam from Greninja. So he beat me with that, which was really cool on his end, the way he that he EVs his stuff after rocks. Like he's done it with Thundee this season of the NPL. But anyway, I was really excited to play against Chris because I had never played him after that day, that game last season. And I didn't really know him very well. I didn't know almost anybody in the NPL. And I've gotten to know everybody, and everybody's really cool. So I'm really glad that I got to meet them. So this game, I'm not going to be able to... Well, I can still pause and stuff, I think. This is running off of the stream. So you guys have the layout of the stream right now. So this is really cool. I downloaded the stream. Sorry, Danza. I did illegally download your stream so that I could use it in my video. I hope you don't sue me or anything. But I'm actually going to lead off with Mega Alakazam. Before we get into the game, let me go over his team. Because I forgot to do that. But Mr. Chris, where are you, my friend? Where is Togavore? Togavore was in E. So if we go to E, right here, Togavore is the Portland Timbers. He actually didn't call himself the Arizona Carvanas for this tournament. He called himself the Portland Timbers, and he has Jirachi, Clefable, Buzzwole, Thundee, Greninja, Nidoking, Mega Blastoise, and Silvally. Before we even started this tournament, I looked at Togue's team, and I was terrified of it, and I did not want to face it. But because of having Jar and Johnny by my side, Jar knows Chris very well, and Jar was helping me build. So we came up with like the most fantastic sets ever. Let me go over my team for Togue, as you guys will see. Where is it? There it is. Okay, so my Infernape is U-turn, Flare Blitz, Close Combat, Gunk Shot, 176 speed. I hit 296, which means I'm faster than his Nidoking. U-turn, Flare Blitz, Close Combat, Gunk Shot, Poisonium Z. Second time that I'm running Poisonium Z this tournament. Third time I'm running a Z Crystal on Infernape. 80 HP, 252 attack, Adamant Nature. So as hard hitting as humanly possible with this Infernape. Tapu Bulu. The first time that I'm bringing Choice Scarfed, I was dying to bring Choice Scarfed Bulu, guys, because Banded Bulu hits like a truck, but it's really slow. Scarf Bulu doesn't have that crutch. It still hits like a truck, because you can still run an Adamant, and it's decently fast because it's running a Choice Scarf. So I ran 233 speed. The reason I ran 233, guys, I'm going to bring up this calculator for you again. 233 times 1.5. Do you see this speed? It hits 349.5. I made it 233 just as a security like a security measure, because 232. Can I even hit 232? Let me check that. Yeah, I can. 232 times 1.5, I believe, still hits the speed that I want to hit, which is 348. Because the reason that I went to this speed, and the reason that I went one speed tier above, 1 point higher, this is incredible, guys. This is actually just incredible. I was speed creeping a non-choice scarfed Greninja, speed creeping my Infernape. That was my game plan, was to speed creep that Greninja. And let me show you guys what happened this game. So I'm going to lead off with Mega Alakazam, which this game is a Psychic Shadow Ball Dazzling Gleam substitute set, max special attack, modest. I just went like full offensive against him. I knew that he could not handle this set looking at his team. So I'm going to straight off lead with it, because if he wants to lead with a Stealth Rocker Nidoking, I'm set. Like, that's amazing for me. I can just Psyshock, or Psychic, excuse me, or I can straight sub, predicting a switch. And that is exactly what I'm going to do, as you guys are going to see. Now, this is taken straight from the stream, so I sped it up a little bit so that we wouldn't be on it as long, but it's still going to take some time between turns, and I might lag like that a little bit because it is a stream video. That I downloaded. So he's going to go out into his Silvally, and I am going to substitute right here. It's also sped up if you didn't notice. He's Silvally Dark. Except Silvally Dark, max HP, max special defense, cannot take two Dazzling Gleams from a modest Mega Alakazam. And knowing that he brought this specifically for my Mega Alakazam, and now I'm sitting behind a sub, and I can just hit it twice and kill it, that is exactly what I'm gonna do. I'm not even gonna hesitate, guys. I'm thinking like, he has no other use for this. This doesn't beat anything else. It doesn't beat my Nidoqueen. It doesn't beat my my Milotic or anything. Like, and he probably has Pursuit. I'm not gonna switch out. There's no point. I'm not gonna try to set up another sub. I like my HP where it's at. I'm not gonna waste 25% for no reason. I'm just gonna attack. And if he switches out, so be it. This thing only beats my Zam. And my Zam beats it at this point. It's at 45%. There is no reason for me to switch this thing out. So I'm just going to go for a Dazzling Gleam. He's going to drop. He's now going to go into Jirachi. And I'm not going to pause it here, actually, because this is going to take a while. He's thinking that he can force me out with his Jirachi. Fearing that he might hit me with a U-turn or an Iron Head and he's Scarfed. But because of my 88 HP, I don't die to U-turn. I don't die to U-turn from this range, guys. So I have no reason not to attack right here. And if he's a defensive set and he's just trying to play me, the following Shadow Ball is about to do a lot of damage. And he goes for sub. And now he's sitting with a Jirachi at 28%. And this is fantastic. Because I can just Shadow Ball again. I'm fine with that. He can hit me with whatever he wants. He's going to hit me with an Iron Head on the following turn. And it's going to do, I believe, about 40%-ish. But it's not going to do enough damage to me. Like, you guys are going to see, it's not going to do enough damage to me at all to warrant me switching out or anything. Like, my Shadow Ball kills from here. There's no reason for me not to click Shadow Ball on this turn. And being that my Mega Alakazam is EV to outspeed a max speed Greninja with 168 speed, and he goes straight into it, I'm thinking here on this turn, he's probably Scarfed. He's probably Scarfed Ninja. Or, I don't know. And he goes for Grass Knot, predicting my switch out into Milotic. The problem here is my Milotic is burned because of Flame Orb. I brought Flame Orb, by the way, guys. I am Marvel Scale, so I didn't mess up there. But I have Miracoat, Recover, Scald, and Haze. So, all I can do in front of this Greninja, and it's going to be very repetitive for the next few turns, is I am going to Recover Stall it. I'm just going to keep going for Recover as it goes for Grass Knot. And this is going to happen over a few turns. So I'm going to forward it a little bit here. And he's just going to keep going for Grass Knot. I'm just going to keep going for Recover. That's exactly what's going to happen for the next few turns. And like, I don't even want to commentate over this because it was actually painful for the stream to watch and for everybody to watch. Like, even myself watching this happen over again was not fun. But I am slowly gaining back health to the point where eventually, if I do predict him to be Scarfed, then I will beat him, because I can switch out at any given moment on one of his Grass Knots. He doesn't know how healthy I want my Milotic to be, so it's either like he makes a misstep and goes for a different move that doesn't do as much damage to my Milotic, and then I'm able to recover up to full, and then he's forced to Grass Knot and I can just switch out. Or he just sits here and I get the switch out on the Grass Knot. So ultimately this is, it might look a little bit stally, but it is a losing battle for Chris. So I'm not even hesitating. I'm just clicking recover over and over and over again. So this is fine. Eventually this does end though, and Chris switches out. I think it's on this turn. Because now I'm up to 75%. And, like, there's no point in him staying in here. I haven't been attacking. I'm just going to end up going for recover again. He knows that. And he's going to actually try to capitalize on this. Because his Jirachi has a lot of HP in it. And it can definitely take my Scald. So he's going to play off of that. He's going to switch out into his Jirachi as I go for a recover. And now he's going to get up a sub. And he is faster than me, clearly, because he's naturally faster than me. And I'm not going to be able to break his sub with Scald. So now he's going to go for an Iron Head flinch on the next turn. And he's not going to get it. And I'm going to break his sub. He can get up another sub here, but it's dangerous because he'll be at 2%. And then he won't be able to do that again. But I am going to switch out into Zapdos. He is going to go for another substitute, actually. And I'm just going to go straight for... what is it? I'm going to go straight for the Thunderbolt. Now, I actually brought Extra Sensory on this Zapdos with Roost and Agility. Because the only thing standing in my way... I'm max special attack, 240 speed. I hit 296, which means I'm faster than his Nidoking at max speed. So he's actually going to Toxic me on this turn. This is quite important because it means that my Zapdos cannot just stay in here and Agility Roost. As long as it wants. Plus, it turns out that I can't beat his Clefable, but I could beat the rest of his Mons with this Zapdos alone. because I'm Agility Roost. So, Extra Sensory helps me out with that and everything. If his Nidoking is Ice Beam, the worst that it can do to me is Ice Beam me for quite a bit of damage, but I can Roost it off slowly, again. Just as I was doing with my Milotic a second ago. But he's gonna go out into his Nidoking knowing that I have to Thunderbolt and I can't click anything else. But now I am going to two-hit KO the Nidoking, as Togekiss is actually going to prioritize getting up rocks. And I actually disagree with this play, because as much as rocks would have done a good amount of damage to my team, and they do a good amount of damage to my team, at the same time, if you can knock out this Zapdos, which is actually quite a big pain, then go for it. But I guess he has a couple more things that can knock it out without my Zapdos ever being able to really come back in. And he doesn't need this Nidoking anymore, guys. So I am just going to go for the Extra Sensory on the following turn. There's no reason for me to click anything else. Anything but Extra Sensory on this turn. Because he's not going to keep it. He's not going to keep his Nidoking for what? To lose to Zam? To lose to Infernape? To lose to Milotic or my Nidoqueen if I have Sucker Punch? Like, it doesn't make any sense for him to keep it. So... at this point, I still haven't sent out Bulu. He has no idea what kind of Tapu Bulu I am. But he's going to bring in his Thunderous. And this actually ends up working out really well on the following turns. He goes for T-Bolt. And once again, guys, my check to Thunderous, which I have run into like four times in this tournament, is my Nidoqueen. And once again, it is Pyapa Berry. But this time, instead of being... I'm missing EVs. Great. Okay. This time, instead of being... max special attack or whatever, I actually brought max HP, max special defense. So you guys are going to see right here, this Pyapa Berry is going to help me out tremendously, because it is going to allow me to take not a psychic, but a shattered psyche. And I take that ridiculously well. I'm still at 54, so he can't even knock me out after the next one. The reason I went for Thunderbolt there, guys, and this was actually, I'm going to pause it right here, because I watched the stream back on this game, just this game specifically, and I heard them talking about why I was, Jolt specifically, was like, why is he going for Thunderbolt? Why is that his play? This is my play, because he has no switch-ins to Thunderbolt. If I go for Ice Beam, and for some reason he switches into Jirachi, then I don't knock it out. Why don't I knock it out? Because I messed up my Nidoqueen. And it actually wasn't Sheer Force. Because if it was Sheer Force, that Thunderbolt would have done a lot more. It would have done roughly about 30%. But because I am... I was Poison Point, I believe. And this was the second time I was Poison Point this tournament. And it doesn't end there. Trust me. Because I am Poison Point, I don't do as much as I want to with the Thunderbolt, but I am going to go for Thunderbolt again, because again, I don't want his Jirachi coming in for free. And what this is going to do is, one, I'm going to live his Psychic unless he crits me, so this is fine. And two, after the next Thunderbolt, believe it or not, Thunderous is actually in range of Scarfed Bulu's Woodhammer. Believe it or not, that's how much damage a resisted hit is doing. It's doing upwards of 60%. It does min 60 to this thing. So he's gonna go for another psychic. It's not gonna knock me out. What the heck just happened? Oh, they switched over to another game for a second. I was like wondering what the heck. I forgot I was watching a stream game. But he is gonna knock me out with the falling psychic, except now he's at 60%. And my Mega Alakazam is still alive, and it outspeeds this easily. So what I can do is I can go into Zam, and even if he's Thunder Wave, if he doesn't full para me, then I knock out his Thunderous. And he's forced to Thunder Wave me here if he has it. He can't risk switching out on a Dazzling Gleam, especially into his Greninja. Like, that's way too risky. So, and if I weaken this thing with Dazzling Gleam, it puts it in Mach Punch range, so he has to keep that in mind. So he's thinking about all this stuff before he makes his play. But he is going to end up Thunder Waving me. And he is going to, and I'm going to Psychic and knock him out. Now, this is where the game gets a little bit interesting. Because once again, this is one of the most technical endgames that I've had to play. Kind of like against Danza. So I guess it's a reoccurring trend with the NPL is technical endgames. But he's actually going to go out into his Jirachi, I believe, here. To knock me out because he knows he's faster. He's going to go into Jirachi and he's going to go for an Iron Head. Don't worry, guys. There's only 4 more minutes left on this game. It actually might be a little bit less because... did I cut it? No, I cut it. Okay, yeah. So it is 4 minutes. It's less than 4 minutes left. So he's going to go out into Jirachi here and he's going to go for Iron Head. And I'm going to be able to take the Iron Head no problem. Not true. I'm a Mega Alakazam. I'm going to die to the Iron Head. But the thing is, his Jirachi is sitting at 20% after leftovers. He can't risk going for anything but an attacking move here, because if I get off a Shadow Ball, then he's dead. So he is going to go for Iron Head. But guess what comes in now? this is the time to reveal my top of Bulu. And I am Choice Scarfed for Chris. So I'm going to go out into Bulu. And I'm just going to fire off a Wood Hammer. He's going to let his Jirachi drop. He can't risk switching into anything. His Clef is going to get 2-hit KO'd. His Greninja is getting OKO'd. Obviously, and this Jirachi is going straight down to this. So I got everything in range of where it would be either OKO'd or 2-hit KO'd by Woodhammer. So this is awesome. I'm still sitting at 85, so about where I was a second ago. So this is all good. He's going to go into Clef. Here's where the complicated endgame starts. I cannot stay in here, because if he goes for Hidden Power Poison, I lose. So I have to get out, and he's going to go out into his Clefable. Now, you guys remember what was happening earlier with the Grass Knots and the Recover stalling with the Milotic? The reason I was doing that was because I can't hit Greninja with Miracle, because it's a dark type. So Chris, great prep on Chris's part, bringing something, a Greninja that could actually take on Milotic for once. I say for once, like compared to all the people that don't bring Greninjas that can deal with Milotics. But I'm going to go for Scald here. He actually crits me with Moonblast, so that reveals the amount of damage that it would normally do after he goes for a Calm Mind. So I'm going to go for a Recover here as he actually goes for another Calm Mind. And right here, I'm going to go for Mirror Coat, and he's actually going to scout for it by going for another Calm Mind. But I also have Haze on this set. Thank you, Jar, for designing my Milotic set. I'm going to be able to Haze away this thing's boosts very easily. And then I'm going to be able to hit it with a Scald on the following turn, and I'm always faster than it. And I have more Hazes, and the problem is I'm burned, and I don't have leftovers. The thing is, I have more Hazes and Mirror Coats than he has stat, than he has PP in general. So I can beat this thing 1v1 very easily. Right here, I make the play of going for Mirror Coat because I figured that he would attack me and not go for another boost needlessly. And I do call this turn correct, actually. Toge is going to make the play of going for Moonblast. But this is actually going to be very good for me. Because Toge is going to go for a Moonblast, as you'll see on this turn, as I go for Miracle. I've already said that, but now there is exactly how much time left. There's a minute left? Oh yeah, there's a minute left. Okay. So Toge is going to go for Moonblast, as I'm going to go for Miracle. It's going to get really fast right here. Now, I'm going to pause it real quick because there's very little time left. I know that if I go into Infernape right now, whether he recovers up or whether he goes for a Moonblast, my Infernape lives. And I have Poisonium Z Gunk Shot on deck, ready for him. So, if he attacks, he also puts me in Blaze, so I can go for a Flare Blitz. But Acid Downpour is always my correct play because he still has a Greninja in the back that can potentially take a Flare Blitz from the range it's at. So, I'm going to make a switch here into my Infernape as Togue does go for the Moonblast. And that is going to put me down to 25%, which Trev said in the stream put me in Blaze. Except I was Iron Fist. I wasn't in Blaze, so Flare Blitz wouldn't have killed. So I'm going to now go for the Acid Downpour on this turn. He cannot switch. He is stuck in here. If he switches into Greninja, he risks losing the game straight up because I still have a Tapu Bulu in the back. And that thing's going to destroy this. And he reveals to be Kebbia Berry, and now he's going to go out into his Greninja. He's going to click Water Shuriken, guys. And do you remember when I busted out the calculator earlier? I'm going to go into Bulu, and I'm going to pause it. This was probably the most hype moment for me. And Jar and Johnny were muted in call, and they were listening to everything that I was saying. I was like, it's fine, guys. You can listen to me. I'm going to be talking to myself. This is what I do when I post comm. And they were listening to me, and I didn't let them tell me anything. But I was terrified. I was terrified right here that... Because, like, if he just clicked Water Shuriken to knock out my Infernape. If he's locked in Water Shuriken, he loses. But I don't know if he's scarfed. And if he's not scarfed, which at this point I'm thinking he's not, then there's a chance that this Greninja outspeeds me and kills me with a Gunk Shot or an Ice Beam right now. And I am scared. I am so scared because I'm going to lose to this thing if that happens. I am just straight up going to lose. But I did call the speed creep correctly, guys. I did call it correctly. And his Greninja only brought enough speed for my Infernape, and I outsped it and Horn Leeched it and killed. And the reason I know that he wasn't scarfed was because he didn't click Water Shuriken. So I got it right. I got the speed perfectly right on point. And I am so happy about that. Oh my god, you guys have no idea. Like, I am sure Togue's speed read 347. 100%. And mine hit 349. So, that was like... That had to be the... I'm going to get this black screen out of the way for you guys. That had to be one of the most hype games that I have ever had. Like, at the end, I was like, yes! Let's go! Like, I'm sorry to yell in your ears, guys, but I was, like, so hyped. I jumped out of my chair. I was so excited that I had just beat Togue. We're back on the game with Dan, but because that was a stream game. But that was such a hype moment for me that actually happened. And this means that we are in top four. We just beat another NPL player. And I'm in top four. And I'm terrified. Again. Because there are one of three players that I can play against. Lars, El Scizor, who we beat last season in the GPC, who hasn't been doing that well in the GBA as of late, but in this tournament, Lars took out huge players, like huge players, like Gypsy. Gypsy King lost to Lars. I believe Shoddy also lost to Lars. Like really, really good players that inspire me and make me want to be as good as them got eliminated by Lars. The other two players were the Carnage guy that I was talking about earlier, and again, Monatui, who is still in this tournament. And I'm like, who am I gonna play? Guys, tell me now. Just do it. And I believe both of our top four matches got revealed. No, sorry. Carnage wasn't anymore. It was Chime. Yes, Chime. Yeah, and Chime is from the IBL. And the IBL is the league that I was helping Eric build for. And I knew how good Chime was. And I've had this conversation with Jose. I was like, Chime is really good. But it ended up that he was playing against Monatui. So we got Lars, El Scizor. And as you guys can see, oh my god, Lars has a scary team. I'm gonna go over it for you guys, but Lars's team. El Scizor, where are you? El Scizor, no. Lars. Where were you, dude? Is he in here? El Scizor, yeah. Alright. Salamence, Zemon, Manaphy, Necrozma, Mamoswine, Decidueye, Greninja, Nihilego, Mega Scizor. Mega Scizor, guys, was the ultimate check to Tapu Bulu. It was the ultimate check to Tapu Bulu. Like, it would always take it on, easily. Except the Tapu Bulu set that I brought. The Tapu Bulu set that I brought against Lars. Let me go over it real quick for you guys. Was Hornleech, Hidden Power Fire, Substitute Toxic. This could handle his entire team. Nihilego, Greninja, Mamoswine, Manaphy, they all get destroyed by Hornleech. I can wear down Salamence and Necrozma with Toxic. And what's the other thing again that he has? I can't even remember now. Decidueye, I can also wear down with Toxic. I'm in grassy terrain, and I have leftovers, so I'm getting back a lot of health. Hidden Power Fire was there to hit the only thing that could stop this from functioning, which was Mega Scizor. His team does not have a Mega Scizor. When I saw that, I was so sad that this set was not going to work, but it could still put in work. My Skarmory, Akaberry, because I figured that if he brings setup mints, and even if he doesn't, he's going to have Fire Blast on it. One way or another, he's going to bring Fire Blast on mints. So I'm going to bring Akaberry Skarmory so that I can at least whirlwind it out if it is set up. And if it gets like a bunch of Moxies, so that I can beat that. He's going to bring mixed, right? So I brought 112 defense with an Impish Nature, 148 Spideth, so that I could take the Fire Blast after Rocks even from max special attack. And then 248 HP. Stealth Rocks, Iron Head, Whirlwind, and Roost. The Infernape was another Choice Scarf set. Oh my god. I'm looking at it now. I'm looking at it now. Oh my god. Okay. Yeah, why is this coming up? Get out of here. My Infernape set was Close Combat, Mach Punch, U-Turn, and Stone Edge. I don't even want to talk about it. Like, this, I'm still staring. I'll talk about it when we get into the game. I have 252 attack, if you're wondering. Rindoberry Milotic with Recover, Ice Beam, Mirror Coat, and Haze for his Manaphy, which is a huge, huge threat. I don't know how the hell Lars drafted this team, honestly. Like, this is a disgusting team. Tapu Bulu, we already went over. Alakazam actually could put in a lot of work against this team. I ran Modest with, again, 378 speed, just like for the last Greninja that we just faced. Max special attack, I have 88 HP. Psychic, HP, Fire, Energy Ball, and Substitutes. So I could always set up subs on something that I scared out. And I can go for Energy Ball on his Mamoswine. He's really weak to grass. I have HP Fire for the Scizor. Again, not going to happen. And Psychic, which hits everything else. Energy Ball actually does a lot to Necrozma, surprisingly. So it was good enough to have that. And finally, we have Nidoqueen. If you guys didn't listen to me earlier, Bolt Beam coverage runs through my team. But you know what runs through my team even harder? A Nihilego. And the only thing I had for Nihilego was Nidoqueen. Unfortunately, I did not want to run Pyapa because I was scared that without the Black Sludge recovery, that I would not be able to take on other of his Mons, because I did run max special attack, max HP, so I wanted the Black Sludge recovery. And my Alakazam. Now, the thing about Alakazam, when you plug in a Mega Alakazam into the team builder on Showdown, I really gotta stop fidgeting with this stuff. When you plug in Mega Alakazam into a team builder on Showdown, it defaults to Trace. And if you don't set its ability before Mega Evolution, that defaults to Synchronize. So I had a Synchronized Mega Alakazam, or a Synchronized Alakazam during this game. And my Nidoqueen was once again Poison Point. This is the problem, guys. This is what I was talking about earlier. Having only 15 minutes to prep for these games is the most stressful thing that I have ever experienced. And a lot of my sets are messed up right now. But I can still pull this out. I can still make it into the top two. So let's see what happened. I can put this on slow. On normal. So he leads off with his Mamoswine. I lead off with Infernape. Immediately I go for U-turn because I know he's sashed. I go into Skarmory. And he's going to go for Earthquake. I'm like, okay, this is fine. This is perfect. He's going to go for Stealth Rocks. And I am just going to go straight for mine. So I get up my Stealth Rocks really early. That's really good. He's going to go for Ice Shard. Break my Sturdy. I'm going to go for Iron Head. And right here, I'm expecting Endeavor. So I'm going to Roost. Predicting his Endeavor. And that ends up working out. So I do get off a Roost. He's going to go for another Endeavor. Thing is, Endeavor has 8 PP. So I can just sit here and Roost. And he can't touch me. Because he is Ice Shard, Endeavor, Stealth Rocks, and I believe Earthquake. So he cannot touch me. He's just going to keep going for Endeavor. And I'm like, Lars, keep it up, man. Keep going for Endeavor. I'm okay with that. I'll sit here and just keep taking your Endeavors and just keep Roosting them off. Because I'm getting back up to the same amount of health every time you do this. Finally, he's going to switch out, and he's going to go out into his Nihilego as I go for another Roost. Now, right here, guys, right here, right here, I'm in Sturdy. His Mamoswine is an Endeavor set. My entire team outspeeds it, or most of them. I want to keep this Skarmory for the Mamoswine. So I'm not going to allow myself to get hit by a Thunderbolt. But Lars is better than that. And he clicks Psychic on my switch out to Nidoqueen. And weakens it to the point where I cannot take another one. And it is, in fact, Life Orb. And because I'm not Pyoppa Berry, I can't take two. So right now, he's going to go for another Psychic. And he's Life Orb. But he also EV'd this thing to get a speed boost instead of a special attack boost. So now I'm here like, ugh, this sucks. This really, really sucks. Like, what do I do about this? I can't go into Mega Alakazam. I'm going to get bodied. Well, I wouldn't get bodied, but it's going to kill me. Like, it's going to do so much damage to me, and I can't risk that. And he can just switch out into his Greninja if he wants to. Wait a minute. I have a Scarfed Infernape. And it is faster than this. I can just go for U-turn. And he's going to switch out. Yeah, okay, perfect. Okay, so he's going to go out into his Ments. He's going to get Intimidate. He knows that I'm Scarfed now. So I'm going to go for the U-turn. That's fine. That's cool. Okay, we're back in this. We're good now. I'm going to go into Skarm. I have the Akaberry, so I'm good. He's defensive, so that's also really good. He's going to go for a Dragon Claw, I guess, testing the waters. I don't know what he was doing exactly. I'm going to Whirlwind him out. So now his Salamence is at 50 when it comes back in. I catch the damn Nihilego again. And now I can't do anything about it. So I'm going to take a Thunderbolt, and I'm going to die. So now this Nihilego is at 46%. Gets another speed boost. It's a problem. If I would have just stayed in with Skarmory, because I had the Sturdy. Actually, I wasn't Sturdy. That's the thing. I messed up on that ability too, guys. And I'm looking at it right now. And it's Keen Eye. And that's why I didn't want to stay in. I was like terrified that he would actually go for Thunderbolt. But he went for Psychic, which was his best play. But now I go back into Infernape. And I'm just going to U-turn again. Actually, this time I think I close combat because I can't risk U-turning anymore. I go for Stone Edge, actually. Trying to catch the Ments because that was his switch in last time. So he reads that very nicely. He goes into Necrozma as a middle ground. Amazing. I'm going to go into Bulu now. As he's going to go for a double into his Manaphy. So this is actually great for me because this is threatening his Manaphy right now. But he sees that I'm leftovers. Ice Beam is not going to kill me though. So he's going to have to get out of here. As I make a very risky, I think, play right here. And go for sub. Knowing that he wouldn't want to sack his Manaphy right there. He needs it too much. So I'm going to go for sub as he goes out into Ments. So perfect. Now I can Toxic this thing. He goes for Roost. I get off of Toxic. So this is awesome. We're looking good, guys. We're looking good again. We're okay. He's going to go for a Fire Blast. I expected this. And I think I actually subbed up again here. Knowing that he'd be able to break my sub. Yeah. Okay. So now I'm good. I subbed again. He is taking rounds of Toxic. He's not going to want to keep having this happen. So he's going to switch out, and he's going to go out into his Mamoswine. Now, his Mamoswine has Ice Shard, so it's going to be able to break my sub. Which kind of sucks, because guess what's coming back in after? You guessed it, Nihilego. So I get to kill off the Mamoswine, which is cool, I guess. I'm sure he's glad that he kept that. But now he gets to go back into Fancy Hats. But it's fine. It's fine. It's cool. It's cool. I'm going to go out into my Milotic. My Milotic can take two hits. He's going to go for a Thunderbolt, actually, predicting my switch out into my Milotic. And this is okay, though, because I can take the hit. And I'm going to recover it off, I think. Because he actually goes out into his Manaphy. So this is cool. I'm gonna recover. I probably should have gone into my Milotic a long time ago on his stupid Nihilego. But he's going to go for an Energy Ball. Knocks out my Rindleberry. So now I have a big problem. I can't stay in on this. But I'm going to switch out into my Mega Alakazam, predicting him to Tail Glow on this turn. And predicting him to predict me to go for an Encore right here. I believe I just go for an Energy Ball. But it is a two-hit KO on his Necrozma, surprisingly. As I am going to go for the Energy Ball. It does a lot. He has the leftovers, but it's still going to be a two-hit KO. So I'm going to be able to knock out this Necrozma. So awesome. Cool. Now, he goes into Greninja. I traced Prism Armor, so I'm an idiot. I'm going to switch out here. I should have stayed in, knowing that if he's bringing it in like this, it's because he's Scarfed. And even if he goes for a Dark move, I have Prism Armor, and I can live it, and I can knock him out. But I switch out, and I go Nibulu, and now his stupid Nihilego's back, and it's in grassy terrain. And I'm going to switch out, and I'm going to go into Milotic, and he's going to go for a Sludge Bomb. He's going to poison me. So this is going to not allow me to get up to the range where I can live a Thunderbolt, unfortunately. Because I am poisoned. So he's going to go for the T-Bolt and he's going to knock me out. But again, it's okay because his Nihilego is sitting at 11%. And I can go back into my Nape. And I can just U-turn again. And we're still okay. What? What the hell just happened? It was at this moment that I knew that I had fucked up badly. Not only did I bring Kenai Skarmory, I did have Sheer Force Nidoqueen, I lied. I changed it on the builder before, but I'm pretty sure I made it Sheer Force. I was sure of that because I had messed it up so many times in this tournament. I made sure it was Sheer Force, but I neglected Skarmory. And apparently, I also neglected to check Nihilego's speed because I thought it hit 334. But actually, it hits 335. And guess how much I was? 334. So, 330. I was 335. I was 335 on my Infernape, excuse me. So that was a speed tie. And Lars wins the speed tie. And as a result, because my grassy terrain is up, he's going to live his life orb hit, and he's going to get back up to 7%. I'm going to go out into Zam. He has plus 2 speed. I trace Beast Boost thinking that I can get extra speed, but it doesn't even matter because he kills himself off to Life Orb. So I'm not even going to get that. And besides, my special attack was higher than my speed, so that didn't matter. Now he's going to go out into his Greninja. He's going to U-turn out because he's Scarfed. And he's actually going to Ice Beam right here. Smart play because it takes out both this. But it doesn't take out Bulu, actually, because I have a lot of defensive investment. So I'm going to go for a Horn Leech right here. I'm actually going to get up to a decent amount of health. His Ice Beam does 63%. And I think that Greninja is actually a little bit stronger than Manaphy, if I'm not mistaken. So he's going to bring in his Manaphy. And I'm probably going to live this. I do not. So guys, that ends my run of March Madness. After 2 hours, if you guys are still watching, I might cut this into two segments. And just make like a little intro and outro on each one. But because of my Miss EV on the Infernape, because Infernape could still put in a lot of work in the endgame, Lars probably brought a Scarf Ninja that was faster than my Mega Alakazam, whereas I brought a Scarf Nape that was faster than his Scarfed Nihilego. So my Nape was probably still faster than his Greninja. And saying that my Nape was faster than his Greninja, if my Nape was still alive, I'm going to get off camera for a second here because I keep dropping stuff. If my Infernape was still alive in that endgame, as you can see, his mana fee is really low. I could just spam close combat. And like his only switch in is Salamence. And Salamence doesn't knock out my my Mega Alakazam from the range it was at because I had 88 HP and he was not attack invested. So I could take the Dragon Claw. I would trace his Intimidate coming in as well. So he would get a minus one in attack. I'd be able to easily take his Dragon Claw, and I could even sub up on the following turn in case his Greninja came in. And then I could sub again in case he went for a dark move. So if he went for a dark move, then he was stuck in with a dark move, and I could just fire off an energy ball. And energy ball killed Manaphy from this range, and Psychic would destroy his Salamence. And even if it didn't, even if it left it with a sliver of health, I just come in with Infernape afterwards, and I click either Close Combat or Flare Blitz, and I knock him out. But because of the miss EV, I lose. So, again, this is where saying that the 15-minute prep is not enough. 20 minutes might be enough, but I'm still not sure about that. Again, it's March Madness, and it comes down to the fact that Lars and the ultimate winner of the person that ultimately ended up winning the entire thing, Monotui, spoilers, they have a lot more draft league experience than I do. I've never done anything like this. This is the first time that I've participated in a tournament like this, and I didn't know it was going to be this rushed, playing every single match. Not to mention that this was the largest tournament that they had, and they had to run it all through one day. They had the most amount of people this time around. So the fact that we only had 15 minutes to prep for each game was... it was way too much for me. But now I know what to be ready for next time. And I honestly feel like I didn't draft one of the best teams. Like, this was a really good team, in my opinion. There are two things that I found out from playing in this March Madness. I love Infernape and Milotic. Like, those are the two things that I found out, was that I love Infernape and I love Milotic. Like, they're two of my new favorite Pokemon in Draft League format. If you guys weren't keeping track, I actually went 7-1 in this tournament. Or was it 6-1? I went 6-1 in this tournament. I beat my three games in pools, and then I beat Fries, I beat Dan, and I beat Togue. So I went 6-1, and I ended in fourth place. I ended in fourth place in a tournament that I never thought that I would make it this far in, because there was a field of so many good players, and like at any given moment I could make a misstep and just lose. I have to give a huge shout out again to Jar and Johnny. Like, they were huge help. Like, I even told Jar at some point, I'm like, make me a Milotic set right now, and he just like copy pasted it into the chat, and I was like, I'm putting that in my team builder, and that's it. Like, I had so little time to prep, and they were there with me. And this went on till like 10 at night, or like 11 p.m. Eastern. For Johnny, it was already like 5 a.m. And he was still helping me. He lives in Germany, and he was still there helping me out. These guys got me to top four. Like, without their help, I wouldn't have been able to make it. Next time, I think I might be able to do it on my own. And I also discovered something about myself through this process. If it's not for all the stress and the mistakes in prep, I'm actually a lot better of a player than I thought I was. Like, a lot better. And I impressed myself this tournament, because I could have very, very easily ended up playing against Monotui in the finals had I just EV'd my Infernape properly. Because if it was 335 speed, scarfed, then it came in on Ninja and just went for either Stone Edge predicting the Salamence, or for close combat and knocked it out. Like, it was really only that. Like, my Greninja still, Infernape still had a few switch-ins on rocks. It could easily come in. So if it wasn't for that little bit of misprep, I speed tied as well, and Lars won the speed tie. Like, nothing against Lars. Lars's prep was insane. It was so good. And the way he played through this entire tournament, like, Mono even said it. How did you predict? They played in finals. He said it in our GBA chat. He was like, how did you predict every single one of my plays? Mono ended up winning, but Lars predicted every single turn correctly. Everything that Mono would do. Like, Lars was playing out of his mind this tournament. He actually went like 8-1. But I'm a lot better than I thought I was. And I had this been like, that's the thing about tournaments like this, though. Like, again, huge shout out to TTM for organizing this. I've said it on Twitter. I've said it in the chats. Like, this was so well organized and so well done. But, like, I don't know how different it would have been if we had more time to prep. Like, if I would have actually been able to review sets, like, look at all my abilities. Like, I'm looking at, I can show you guys this now. This is my team for Lars. Like, these are all my teams. All the ones that you guys saw. These are all of them right here. I even had one ready for Uzi because I thought I would face him at some point because that's what it looked like in the bracket. I'll show you guys that. We brought Rocky Helmet. We brought Defensive Infernape for Weavile and Mega Scizor, which is really funny. I just brought a fully defensive Nape with enough speed to outspeed his base 100s, which he had quite a few of. We brought an offensive Zapdos like this, didn't even have the right amount of EVs. This Scarf Bulu with HP Fire on it and Zen Headbutt. This is a cool team. I wish I would have been able to use it. We didn't even EV the Skarm. And this was another Akaberry Skarm. Very similar to the one that we brought, actually. But yeah. So, a couple of things that went wrong for me in that game that could have been avoided. For sure, this is the team. We have Akaberry Skarm, Kenai, as you can see. Nidoqueen was Sheer Force. Infernape, I readjusted here and I brought it back to 335 because I checked during the game and this is what it was at. It's speed tied with his Nihilego. And it's funny that should happen to me because not only did Fries bring the wrong team for me, but of all the people that I critiqued on not bringing enough speed on his Magearna to beat Chimp's team with a Scarf in the GBA, yeah, we critiqued him on that. We actually critiqued him on that a little bit. Like, Chimp's prep was weird for that, but and the way that he played it. But ultimately, the Magearna didn't have enough speed to outspeed the Dugtrio, even if it was scarfed, because he EV'd it in a way that he would outspeed. He would speed creep a creeping Dugtrio, and it's just insane that this happens to me. Because I'm a power rankings analyst. I critiqued both of them on how they played that endgame. And then I end up against Lars, and this happens. Where I don't have enough speed for his freaking Nihilego. Like, literally, all I needed to do was this. And that game was mine. 4 speed points. And that game was actually mine. It literally, it was like, not only was it that, and had I looked at Nihilego, I would have had it. And plus, if my Skarmory was actually sturdy, I might have actually stayed in on his, I also needed this for Ments because I hadn't seen what kind of set his Ments was, but if I would have EV'd this, if I would have had the right ability, like sturdy on this, I would have probably just Iron Headed his Nihilego and just attacked it because it would have dropped to Iron Head. Like, I can show you guys the calc right now. It's probably not going to be perfectly on screen. Actually, yeah, it will be. You guys are going to see right now. Nihilego, and if he was rocking max speed, if he was timid, then he actually had to be less special attack on here to actually get the speed boost every time. So I'm gonna drop this a little bit and make it this, which means that he was 176, so he had about 80 investment in HP. So let me just show you guys Skarmory, like a standard specially defensive Skarmory with Iron Head. 68 to 81. After that thing hit me with a psychic life orb, after rocks damage, it was dead. It was gone. Like, this did 70%. He only had one hit left in him, and I would have switched out to Nidoqueen at that point. I would have taken a psychic like it was nothing, because I still had some special defense investment, and I would have switched out. And as you can see, his special attack was only 334, so I would have been able to take that. So, unfortunate, that's how it had to go down in the top four. But ultimately, I would have ended up playing against Monotui. And I did have a game plan for him, because I had already looked at his team and I knew that there was a chance that we could end up playing in finals. And there was a very good chance, because Mono's amazing. But he did end up winning. I think saying that I would have been second place would have been better than saying that I ended up fourth place, but, like, still, I didn't expect to do this well, guys. Like, I really did not expect to play this well and perform this well, build this well. I had a lot of help, but still, like, everything went so well. Johnny and Zazzo, unfortunately, didn't make it through, but we still pushed the GPC into the top four. So I truly believe that we have some of the best players in the GPC, between Zazzo. Like, competitively, if I had to amass a group of 16 players from the GPC, the NPL, and every, like, 16 players from every league that there are, I would personally put the GPC in the top three, because I truly believe that we have some of the best players in there. Like, including myself, Zazzo, Jose is incredible when he wants to be, like, when he's on his game, and he hasn't even been on his game, and he's still been winning, winning like crazy. Baby Eric, Jar, Johnny, Risepool, like, there's the Ethan, we have so many good players, so much talent. I would have to put us in top three if we're making comparisons, like, of top 16 players, like, easily. And I'm glad I got to show that. I'm glad I was able to push the GPC into the top four and gain us some recognition, because, like, there were a lot of people watching the stream at the beginning, quite a few, and there were over 200 people who tried to apply and participated in this tournament. Like, I'm really glad that we got to, I got to show off, what the GPC can do, because Johnny got hacked to hell. So, yeah. Another thing is, it was actually really funny. We were, like I said, there were a bunch of stories going on during this, this tournament, but one of them was that I was constantly, sorry about scratching my ear like that, I was constantly in the GBA chat checking up with, like, Burke, who had been eliminated. He was actually participating as well. And with CJ, and at the end, when Mono won, we all hopped into the GBA chat, because at three out of four of us, there was Chime, and then there was me, Mono, and Lars. And me, Mono, and Lars are all in the GBA chat. We're all GBA affiliates in some way. Mono, we've been putting at number one. Lars is also a coach, and I'm a power rankings analyst. Like, we were all there. We were all just talking. It was really cool to see, like, the GBA really come out strong. And, like, I really think that personally, like, after this tournament, I even said it in the chat. I was like, all right, if anybody drops out, if there's an open spot in the GBA next season, I have a capture card now. I showed you guys what I can do. You better give me a spot. Like, I was joking around, but I honestly feel that with my the size of my following, because I know that they do count subscribers, when they're picking coaches, like, they look at that. But, like, you look at Gio, you look at Lars, like, their channels grew a lot because of the GBA, because before that, they weren't that, their sub counts weren't there that high. So looking at that, I feel like I would be a pretty good fit for the GBA. My commentary is not bad at all. I have a capture card now, and my content is overall decent. I have a decent channel size for what they look for, so I think I could pull that off. I said it jokingly, but I truly believe that, and that's always been my goal. That's been my dream, is to be a coach in the GBA. And that would be awesome if I could play against people like MV and Chimp week after week. And initially, my biggest dream was to play against Shady, because I was a huge Shady fanboy, and I know I've said that a million times, but I'm also an MV fanboy, and I'm a Dan fanboy, and, like, I like all of these guys. Like, the word fanboy has kind of been erased from my vocabulary, actually, because I've gotten to talk to these guys, and, like, they're just normal people. They're really cool, you know, like, people that I've been watching on YouTube for a long time. Like, I've been watching MV for, like, a year and a half, easily, even over that, like, 2 years, probably. Like, I was watching MV way before I started doing YouTube. So, being able to talk to all these people and being in this awesome community has really opened my eyes to, like, how cool people are. And that's a big thing that I have to take away from this, is that while I didn't have time, guys, to, like, talk about my games after they happened with my opponents. We didn't have time for that, because we only had 15 minutes to build. Otherwise, I would have talked to Lars about the game a lot more. I would have talked to Togue about the game, because that was one of my I think that had to be my favorite game, was against Togue. Because I think I played that just the right amount of aggressive to beat him. And it was perfect. Like, Togue doesn't like aggression.
He really doesn't like aggression when playing, and I know that because I watch him a lot. I watch a lot of his games. He's really fun to watch, so you guys should go check him out. Like I said, I'll be leaving a link to all of my opponents in the description. A lot of them have really good size channels, so please go and check them out. Like Dan, Togue, and Lars, actually my last three opponents, have pretty massive channels. Like, I think they're all in high, possibly not Togue, but the other two are definitely way higher sub counts than I am. They're like 1500 and 2500. Definitely go check them out. They've got great content, guys. But yeah, overall, like I said before, we're already at 2 hours and 25 minutes, but this was an amazing experience. I would do it again. I would do it all over again. Yeah, as stressful as it was, I loved it. So, yeah, that's pretty much it. Thank you guys if you stuck through the entire thing, and I don't know how you would. This is really just me venting and talking, but you're still looking at a screen. Actually, you're looking at me because I'm zoomed into the camera. So, at this point, like, if you've made it this far, wow, you guys are amazing. Honestly, thank you so much for watching and listening to me rant on and on and on about Pokemon. But these were crazy games. I wish I could have live caught them and like uploaded them as they were happening, because they were incredible. They were actually incredible, but I didn't even think to do it, and I was under so much stress. I just had to play build. Like, I'm really glad I get to move back to like regular league prep, because like where I actually have time to think about everything and calc everything. Because like, that's the thing though, you have to, for a tournament like this, you would literally need to know every single calc offhand, and because you're spending a lot more time just looking at the team, analyzing and thinking, okay, is this better, does this synergize with this, what's going to happen. You have to see the field of play. But with a tournament like this, you don't have time to do all that. You don't have time to run calcs. You don't have time to properly EV stuff or make sure that all your abilities are correct or that your items are correct or anything like that. So I'm really happy to get back to regular league prep. We've got our GPC match coming out on Saturday. Actually, at first, I have my NPL Miners match against David, which I haven't played yet, but I haven't even prepped for it yet, to be perfectly honest with you guys. When I'm recording this, which is Sunday night. Yeah, Sunday night. But I haven't prepped for that at all. But with the speed at which I prepped for these matches, like, I know I had help, but I can very quickly do my prep for David. So I'm not worried about that. NPL Miners, we're sitting at a 4-2 record. We make playoffs no matter what, by the way. And depending, our placement depends on how well we do against David. Like, if we lose, we're still in third, but if we lose by more than 4, like 4-0 or more, we end up in fourth. That's going to depend on who we play. I can either play against Adam, the Bee's Knees, who replaced Clover, which was our first opponent, or I could either play Rob. So somebody that I've already faced, no matter what, which I find kind of weird. Like, why aren't we facing like interdivision in playoffs? Guys, let me know that if you're from the NPL and you've gotten this far. But that's going on. And then the GPC, we have our week 8 game, second to last week, going up on Saturday. Another game that I haven't played yet, but I can play that way later in the week. We are going to be taking on Melon. Melontosh. This is going to be the first time that I actually play Melon. I've been watching Melon, and he was in the GOT with us. He had a really cool team that ended up, he didn't like it, but it ended up doing pretty well for him, honestly. Yeah, like, I think he got 3 wins in pools, if I'm not mistaken. But yeah, I have to play Melontosh, and that should be an interesting matchup, to say the very least. He's not been doing well this season, I can tell you that much. I think he's third to last in Grand. He's still a very good player, very solid. He beat Josh the other week with a really cool Clefable set. He brought Scarfed Clefable. Wow. Yeah, that was just good prep. Yeah, I'm waning away here. Anyway, guys, thank you so much for watching. Again, like, you guys are awesome if you made it this far. I don't know how I've been able to, like, stare at a camera and talk to you guys like this for this long. I've never done something this long on camera before, but I really wanted to record this and show you guys what my trip was like through this entire experience. So,
If you have stuck around with me and you have watched the whole way through, especially to my closest of friends, thank you so much for all the support. It's almost been a year. It's going to be a year in about a month from now that we've been uploading and that this channel has been active. And I just want to give a huge shout out to everybody. Like, this is kind of... This is kind of the way to close out the year was through March Madness. If this can happen every year from now on, and I can always participate, I would love to. I would honestly love to. And I feel like that even if I'm not an all-star for some reason, in whatever league that I'm in, like if I'm not coming as in the all-star division, I truly feel like I can be one of the best in the open division. So, yeah. That's pretty much it, guys. Again, thank you so much for watching. Leave a like if you did enjoy this. I don't know if I split it up into two parts or if I left it as one, but either way, leave a like on both videos if it's split into two. Definitely go check out all of my opponents in the description, guys, just in case they upload something similar and they go through all their games. I know Leo did it, for his run. His run was a little bit shorter than mine, but, no offense to Leo. He's a great guy. But, yeah. Again, thank you so much for watching. Go and check out those guys in the description. Subscribe if you haven't already. And I will catch you guys in a bit. Goodbye.